Hey there, Internet. I'm Annie.
I'm Lucas.
And I'm Anna.
And this is I Will Fight You, Wolfpäc Edition, a podcast where we've still been turning Infinity into facts, Stone Cold Facts, and Saint 86. Fuck, it's a different one and I don't know it anymore.
Ow! Wolfpäc.
It's fine. Don't worry about it. Hello.
Hello, everyone.
And today's fact is Lucas's. What is today's fact?
Do you think you can't do what you love? Make art and create beauty in the face of corporate greed and a capitalist hellscape? You get that weak shit off my track.
Hey-o! I wasn't ready for that.
Aw, excellent.
We're talking about Speed Racer.
We're talking about the 2008 Wachowski Speed Racer. Y'all buckle the hell up.
Question, is it Wachowski or Wachowski?
I said Wachowski.
I don't think it actually matters whether or not we're on the same page on that one.
Eh, who cares? They ain't gonna listen.
The important thing is trans.
So trans.
It's gay in here, folks.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, this is such a gay movie. Considering this is the return of the Wolfpäc team.
Yes.
I bumped my mic with Too Sweet. I think we should sum up the mission statement of I Will Fight You, Wolfpäc.
Yeah.
I think in the discussions of this episode and the previous episode of Hackers and potentially future episodes, we've realized our wheelhouse, and you just imagine me like walking up to a beat up old car and smacking it on the bonnet and saying, you can fit so much movie in this baby.
We do the most movie per movie every movie.
And that's a guarantee, folks.
Take that shit to the bank.
Yeah, we've got a short list of movies that have a lot of movie. Some of them you probably know and love. Some of them you've probably never seen. And some are returning champions to the I Will Fight You scene.
That's right. We got a repeat in the works.
It's coming.
Shh. And it will be here soon. Sorry.
I love movie. I've always loved movie.
So coming back to Speed Racer, so you might know
Speed Racer.
It's based on the 1966 manga and the 1967 anime by Tatsuo Yoshida.
Originally called Mach Go Go Go, that was dubbed over here as Speed Racer.
Mach Go Go Go.
Same theme, always a banger.
It has not been out of my mind since we watched the movie.
Also, I didn't know that. So Speed Racer is the first and last name of our titular character, the eponymous Speed Racer. In Japan, though, he is called Go Mifune, which apparently is a direct reference to Toshio Mifune, one of the best actors to ever live, and also total dreamboat.
He's totally handsome. Oh,
he's
my God.
So handsome.
Pretty. Oh, he never stopped being handsome, ever, God. Ever, ever.
And the nice thing about the Makigogo thing is that Go is, of course, the number 5, and his car is the Mach 5.
Oh, yeah.
It's just puns all the way down. This is like heaven.
Yeah, it works on a lot of levels.
Look, Teen Titans had to get it from somewhere. That's why it's Teen Titans Go. There's 5 of them.
That's right. Did you just now get it? Did you just now get it in the Eurolore 2024 when Puffy Amiyumi said 1, 2, 3, 4, go Teen Titans? They were still counting?
What?
Yeah.
I haven't seen Teen Titans, but I have seen the intro, and you just blew my mind.
Oh, we got a live one!
You got a live one.
Oh, I'm very
good
happy.
Grief.
So this movie was written and directed by the Wachowski sisters, and they self-describe it as an assault on every modern aesthetic, whereas critics refer to it as pop fascism in one case.
Yeah, this is a movie that had labored in development hell since 1992 in some form or another, basically because somebody optioned the rights to make a Speed Racer movie, which seemed like a shoo-in, especially since you're talking about like the 60s and 90s. That's like your 30-year nostalgia gap, so it's like ripe for the pickings. 1995, Johnny Depp was cast in the lead role for Speed Racer.
Really?
Which, honestly, I could kind of understand at the time because that's him in his, like, non-offensive dreamy boy era.
Oh, yeah. Was that his Jump Street era?
They were going to have Henry Rollins from Black Flag as Racer X.
God, right?
Oh, wow.
Eventually, the director left that project. It got abandoned for a while. They kept the rights. I'm honestly shocked that an ashcan copy of this movie didn't come out at some point. At some point, Vince Vaughn was attached for Racer X.
Young, fresh off of Swingers, pretty baby Vince Vaughn.
Huh.
Baby Vince Vaughn.
Wow.
And he wanted to play Racer X.
Yeah, and then the movie just eventually made its way from director to director to director to screenwriter to screenwriter to screenwriter and finally landed in the lap of the Wachowski sisters. At the time, I believe Lana actually came out in conjunction with the release of Speed Racer. Lily would not transition for several years, but I love the fact that she timed her coming out with Speed fucking Racer.
Of all things.
Because my God, this movie.
Oh. Now, did anyone recognize the name of the guy who did the music?
I did not actually see that name. Tell me about it.
Me neither, yeah.
Are you familiar with Michael Giacchino?
Oh, shit. The name sounds really familiar.
Well, let me give you a list to react to, shall I?
Hold up. Quick guess. Is this the guy who writes all of the titles of his score tracks as, like, weird inside jokes just for him?
There are a few of those, but let me give you a list.
Oh, dear.
All right, all right, all right.
This is only a few kind of indie movies. You probably haven't heard of all of these.
Okay, let's go.
The Incredibles. Ratatouille.
Yep.
Mission Impossible,
yep,
3, 4, and Forward. Planet of the Apes. The Batman. All
what?
Three new Star Trek movies. Up. Jurassic World 1 and 2. Inside Out. Doctor Strange. Rogue One. Spider-Man Homecoming. Coco. And I'm going to lean back from the mic as I say this. Jupiter Ascending.
Yup.
Well, how about that?
He's your boy, Annie.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. This is the guy. This is the guy. Like, this is just what he does. He makes weird little jokes for himself in a lot of the scores for a lot of these. Like, for example, here's a track from Ratatouille called End Creditouille. Or number 17, Heist to See You.
Oh, I love him.
Yeah.
I need to go through his entire works now.
Oh, God, I did not know he did the Jupiter Ascending, though.
Oh, start with The Incredibles. The Incredibles score bangs. It's
oh my
real
God.
Good.
It's so amazing.
The Incredibles score is so... You could just listen to that one just by itself, and it is always amazing.
Makes washing the dishes an epic adventure.
It really does. Oh, man. That just makes so much sense that it's this guy. I love it. Please go on.
So if we were going to put the viewpoint of this movie in a nutshell, right? It's that car racing is the most important thing in the world to everyone. Imagine the entire society of this world is built around car racing.
Yeah, we're really going for like the sports anime style of this one thing, this hyper-specific niche is also the most important thing in the world. So we're working on like Yu-Gi-Oh! Rules here.
Like literally all the markets of everything.
We'll be coming back to the Yu-Gi-Oh! Rules, by the way.
Also, because this was before The Matrix Resurrections, it was before Lana Wachowski got out her hammer that says, I am sick of being subtle across the head of it. Anytime someone says driving or racing cars or racing in this movie, I want you to imagine at least one of the Wachowski sisters saying, making movies instead or making art.
Yeah.
Because that is the thesis of this movie. I said it in the fact, and it's the truth. This is a movie about creating beauty in the face of overwhelming capitalist hellscape.
There's a point where, like, one of the characters makes this direct allusion, and you may think that it's just, like, a metaphor. No, it is the thesis point of the entire film.
And it's delivered by one of the best voices in the movie, too.
Capitalism will take a thing you love, reduce it to its component parts, sell it off for scrap, and give you the wreckage and make you say thank you. It's rough, but there is hope in this. I'm not going to say it's hope punk. I hate hope punk. Please don't say hope punk.
You'll get this in a lot of modern pieces of art. That is why people say comics will break your heart. Video games will break your heart. This is a recurring theme in that the ability to make art is a wonderful thing that has been beaten out of people by the awful way the industry treats them over and over again. But God, you love it though.
And I think especially in 2023, it's incredibly
Jesus
potent
Christ
to say something about how your art is grisped for the capitalist mill and it can be buried by an algorithm and it can be deleted for tax purposes. And you can let that discourage you, or you can create your art in spite of that. And this was 14 years ago.
They really saw the future with that one.
There's this thing about the way that this movie is made, and like, this movie is color. This movie is very, very, very in your face. It is an overt film. And one thing that I really think about this is, honestly, when I was watching this, I think a lot about, like, you almost compare it visually to those live action Dr. Seuss movies, like The Grinch or The Cat in the Hat, where it's just, it is a visual assault. Except this one is done, like, understanding what color and film are.
It's like taking one of those visual assault films, mixing it with, like, Spy Kids 1.
Yes.
For the consistent visual style with actual purpose, and combining it into something that hurts to look at, but it is saying something.
Pop art is very much the correct comparison here. You can look up and talk about, like, what the Wachowski sisters' choices were, their inspirations, their intentions, like... There's this bit here in the Wikipedia page where it says, according to Lana, representatives of Warner Brothers were initially gleeful that the directors chose to take on, quote, a known entity that seemed like a family movie for kids. But when executives reviewed the work in process, they were like, oh my God, are you insane? What are you doing? This is the weirdest thing I've ever seen. And we're like, yes, that's the reason we're making it.
It's beautiful. Truly beautiful.
The Wachowski sisters don't really make, like, I don't think they make really good movies, but they make really good movies.
That's a very apt way to put it.
And the thing is, this is something we'll get into when we get into especially the first half hour of this movie, where this movie is teaching you how to watch it.
Oh, man.
But this is an extremely postmodern movie in that it is using all of the aspects of the movie making process to give you more views into these characters and what they think. Like, you will have, you know, a pan by of some people in an audience, and you will zoom in on one person. You will then get a flashback of a scene from that person's point of view. You will then fly back out of that and go and get the flashback from the next person's point of view as their head floats across the screen to wipe and give you this view, and it wipes back and they're back in the scene. It's seamless and fat, and it gives you no time to reorient yourself. But what we're seeing is it's a way of, like, I've actually only can compare it to, like, certain tabletop role-playing settings where you can pull a flashback out of your backpack if you need to say you set up something earlier.
The Bill and Ted style of storytelling.
Exactly. Yeah. I've seen it in Scum and Villainy and in a few other games like that. But it's like, oh, don't worry, I planned for this eventuality. Cut back to you planning for this eventuality to better or worse, depending on your role.
This movie has such a distinct visual language that it really does take a learning curve to figure it out. But once you're on board, honestly, I love it.
Me too. So had either of you seen this movie before?
No. I have heard about this for years from people. Anytime that I've said, no, I haven't actually seen Speed Racer, all of my friends who know me are like, oh, Annie Creighton, you need to watch Speed Racer. So this was finally my excuse to do so. I did also know about this movie in advance in some detail because of Jay Edidin's extremely good blog post that he wrote years ago as part of his coming out of an essay on a trans reading of Speed Racer as a film, because he loves this movie so much.
What's a wonderful piece of writing. Jay's so great.
Yeah.
What about you, Anna? Had you seen this?
I had seen it once because the movie came out when I was 16 and I saw it not in cinemas. I saw it at home, but it never stuck with me. And I think that was because I didn't understand how to critically consume media at that time. All I saw was bright colors. Oh, it's a movie for kids, and kind of didn't really pay attention. So I consider this to be my true first time watching it because it was the first time I absorbed anything beyond, oh, bright colors is for babies. I am a big young man who knows how to media. No, honey, you're wrong on every single count there.
Everything you just said is wrong.
Exactly.
Meanwhile, I consumed this media the way it was intended, in that I got a DVD, my mail service called Big Pun Movies, and I got it and I ripped it through DVD Ripper and Handbrake and put it onto my iPod video so I could watch it on the treadmill at the gym on a tiny screen.
You watched it on your iPod?
On the treadmill as God intended. Holy shit.
Oh, but wow, that's a lot of visual movie to pack into that tiny little screen. Could that thing even handle all of the colors in this shit?
It gave it a shot. It also was one of those treadmills that had the old iPod connector on it, and you could blow it up onto a tiny 480p screen in front of the treadmill.
Oh, bless.
Oh, that's precious.
It's not quite watching it on your watch while you eat spaghetti in the bath, but it is close. But then I did get a chance to watch it properly later. I think I found the Blu-ray on for cheap and watched it properly and really reappreciated this movie. At one point, I was over at Kimika's house in the early part of our relationship.
Aww.
Saw that it had just started. Saw it was the bit that we'll get to where Speed is trying to break Rex's record at Thunderhead.
Mm-hmm.
And watched the movie with her from there and then started the movie over so that you could watch the beginning and have that bit make sense.
Oh, wow.
I'm surprised she stayed with me.
Yeah, this is not a movie that you want to come into in media res in any way, shape, or form, aside from how the filmmakers intended.
Honestly, this isn't even a movie you really want to blink during.
No, there is so much happening. Before we get started proper, I have a couple little bits of information that is very important for the I Will Fight You ethos.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
This movie stars a gentleman named Emile Hirsch, who got his big break in television on an episode of a little TV show about vampires.
No.
Called Kindred the Embraced.
No.
Episode 4, as Abel, parentheses, pediatric patient.
Oh. He was the littlest cancer patient. He was dying of blood.
That's him. He's the littlest cancer patient, and he's all grown up here.
Oh, no.
Good Lord. So that means he hung out with just some guy.
Oh. Yeah.
Who was the ugliest man on the planet.
Wow.
Yeah. That's him. I needed this. I saw Kindred the Embrace in the IMDb profile, and I'm like, holy
what
shit.
What was that? I looked at his IMDb profile and somehow missed this critical information.
Listen, it all comes back around. It's I Will Fight You, baby. Oh. It's layers within layers.
There's no escaping.
A couple of acting tidbits. This also stars Racer X, who was played by Jack from Lost. Like, the main guy from Lost. God, he still got that chin. This is slightly before he landed that role in Lost. Really hasn't done a lot since, which honestly, at the time, didn't need to. And also, of course, Pop's Racer is played by none other than John Goodman, who in this movie married Speed's mom, Susan Sarandon.
Oh,
good for you, John Goodman.
She has some incredible outfits in this one, and also just some incredible scenes.
Susan Sarandon is just a national treasure, honestly. But speaking of incredible outfits, we would be remiss if we did not cast a special little gay highlight on every millennial's childhood crush. Christina Ricci is in this, and she is Trixie, who is Speed's girlfriend.
Trixie rules.
And she has some incredible outfits.
Trixie rules a lot.
The first scene in the car, her outfit. Oh, I can't wait to get to that.
Yeah.
I'll mention this when we get to it, but you'll notice that every outfit Trixie wears is specifically involving a primary color like the same red that's used on the Mach 5 or a checkerboard pattern like a checkered flag, because she knows this is the only way to get Speed's attention.
Yes.
You're so right. Oh, no. He's only horny for cars.
Speaking of cars, by the way, the original Speed Racer manga and anime, was it officially an anime? Annie, you're smart about this stuff. Well, was it like just a cartoon at that point, or was it officially anime?
Yeah, Annie may know.
Well, how do you mean, like, officially an anime?
Well, I mean, is it referred to within the same breath as something that I, a doofus, would know as anime, or was it too early for that?
Okay, so at that point, I mean, in the United States, for instance, where it was brought over as Speed Racer, it wouldn't have really been called an anime at that point, or even Japanimation. You didn't start getting that until, like, you had the anime boom in, like, the 90s.
Oh, yeah, I remember that. There was ads that would say, like, move over Beavis and stuff.
Exactly. So this would have just been considered, like, a cartoon at this point in the United States, albeit a cartoon clearly from Japan or something. In the same vein as like in the early 80s, you'd get like on Nickelodeon, you'd get like the Lil Bits or like the Noozles or stuff like that. That was like clearly not American, but we don't really have a word for this yet. But I mean, in retrospect, it is considered in sort of the canon of North America. It is an anime.
Okay.
But you also don't really have people that will call this character Go Mifune. That's Speed Racer.
Yeah, yeah.
Because, I mean, I didn't see Speed Racer as much when I was a kid in the same way I saw, like, Astro Boy or Voltron on Saturday mornings. I would catch the occasional rerun of it.
These are, like, 60s cartoons. They were, like, gone from your regular airing thing. It was mostly, like, what does the nostalgia your, like, older cousins have for cartoons? Speed Racer, maybe? Or, of course, the, honestly, reference more often than you would think, the Saturday Morning Breakfast cereal punk rock album that covered various theme songs. Had a real good Speed Racer one on there.
In any case, though, this movie, and if the two of you will look at the chat, I've put a few pictures in. The cars in this movie and before that in the anime were inspired by Grand Prix culture of the 40s and 50s into the 60s. So this was the precursor of Formula One. And what it was, is a lot of these were endurance races. So you would go for long distances on public roads through sometimes crazy circumstances. And that all kind of died away thanks to 1955 with the Le Mans crash that killed, no joke, 82 people.
Holy shit.
They had a stand full of fans. One of the cars took a corner in a funny way as it overtook somebody, caught air, and the entire car went into the stand in pieces. It was horrific. There's
Holy
a very
crap.
Good Well, There's Your Problem episode about it, breaking down exactly what happened and the consequences that literally banned motorsport in some countries. But if you look at the cars and things, I'm not a car guy. I'm not a racing guy. I am a mid-century design guy. If you look at some of these cars, they are fucking gorgeous. Like the Mach 5, especially in the cartoons and in this movie, is based on the Ferrari Testarossa. I think it was the 250. Don't quote me on that. There's a picture of it in there. And if you look at how the headlights are off to the side on sort of their own sections, and there's that long nose that comes down, that's exactly the Mach 5.
The lines are so beautiful.
Apparently, one of the inspirations for either Mach Go 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 or the creator Tatsuya Yoshida's previous series, Pilot Ace, actually came from two films that were popular in Japan at the time, according to Wikipedia, Viva Las Vegas, starring Elvis Presley, and Goldfinger, of course, the James Bond film. So he kind of combined, like, Presley's neckerchief and pompadour and Bond's, like, as this list, the gadget-filled Aston Martin DB5.
It's all very good and very cool if you know what you're looking for. And so much of that has been imported and then run through this, like, neo-futurist, Z-Rusty kind of space-age 60s lens. And it's all just so cool.
Honestly, like, 60s space future and, like, Art Nouveau space future, we need to return to those aesthetics.
Reject modernity. Embrace tradition that was the modernity future of that tradition, I think.
Listen, speaking as someone who has a lot of opinions about what the proper design of the Tomorrowland areas in the Disney parks is, we got it right the first time.
More fins on things, more rings around stuff.
More fins, more cool rings. Rings are cool.
More glass bubbles.
They're not stupid, they're cool.
Shh, don't let anyone hear you say that.
Hey, did that guy just say rings are cool?
Nope. He said they're stupid.
Cool!
By the way, Lucas, I have a quick check for you because there is a thing that I have been thinking about perpetually since I watched this movie. I forget. Are you a home movies guy?
No, I'm not. I know Andrew Isla is, and Andrew Isla has recommended home movies to me a great deal, but what's the thing?
It's an episode called Bye Bye Greasy, and there is a song that Coach McGurk sings that's like, I'll race to feel the wind in my face, and I'll race to feel like I own this place, and I'll race against the other racers, and I'll race with one big shout, and I'll race against myself. And I have been thinking about it this entire time, and I am going to need you to look that up and then just throw it in here as you see fit throughout this episode, please.
Sure, I will do.
As a favor for me.
I'll race to feel the wind in my face, and I'll race to feel alive, and I'll race to feel like I own this place, and I'll race until I die. I'll race against the other racers, and I'll race with one big shout. I'll race against the clock, and I'll race against myself, and I'll race, and I'll race.
It's a musical episode, Lucas. This is a stage play where everything goes wrong.
Of course it is.
Yes. Anyway.
So now let's talk about the actual movie.
Yeah, we've talked in circles around this movie. Now let's actually talk about the movie that goes in circles. I'm good. Thank you. I'm good at this shit.
So, even the opening titles get kaleidoscope backgrounds around them.
Oh, man.
The colors are heightened. Everything is
even the studio cards.
There's no hesitation. It just happened.
And then, like we've just waded through a credit scene on an arcade machine, we are punched in the face by, no, the Wachowskis present. No, a something production. Boom! Speed Racer with red and yellow checks.
And like you've got the little horn section and everything. Da, 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 da. You know what movie this is.
Yes. Buckle up, fuckers. It's Speed Racer.
You're watching a movie about Speed Goddamn Racer. And this whole thing just starts with the most colors per movie. Like, you know all the bits in Spider-Verse where their atoms aren't real jazzed about being in the wrong universe and they start glitching out? Imagine if that was the movie, the whole movie.
Every single part of it, the whole time, nonstop.
And we start in a locker room, and amidst this sea of color, there's a figure in white. Entirely in white. White jeans, white polo shirt, with just a splash of color of a scarf around him. And this is adult Speed Racer.
We only see him from behind for a while. Instead, we cut to his foot tapping. He's got this endless rhythm. And then we suddenly cut back in just a blink to that same foot, much younger, in a pair of sneakers in his classroom as we meet young Speed taking a test, again, from behind.
The shoes have drawings all over them, including a race car. He's baby.
He has written the word go, 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 go all across it. And did y'all ever write in whiteout on your backpack or on your pencil case? Because I did.
Of course.
I would have gotten crucified if I did that. So no, because I was a good little kid. I was a brown noser.
There's this point where, like, he's reading the test and the camera scans down it, but then all the text transforms into blah, 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 all drivers to your cars, please, all drivers to your cars.
And so he's been trying to fill out the Scantron sheet. Like, you see him agonizing and he's, like, fidgeting, and he suddenly, when he reads all racers to your cars, he erases everything on the page and he glances up as the second hand on the clock goes to reach the top of the hour. At which point we hear a gunshot and suddenly we cut away to his mom being told that he's distracted.
Honestly, like, this is where you start to get to the thing where the teacher just lays this out. Speed Racer only cares about racing. He only cares about cars. He has written on his Scantron the words, "Go Rex, go if you turn it sideways," which is the name of his older brother, who is a racer. He's making flipbooks on his worksheets that turn into racing cars. Honestly, we have a very good essay about this kid being trans. I would love to see an essay about this kid being neurodivergent, because this is a hyperfixation to end all hyperfixations, and I love it for him.
The whole family is like that, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, all of his fidgets of, like, he's spinning his pencil, he's tapping his foot, his hand is going, like, this is very clearly something's going on there. And as he is drawing this flipbook of cars crashing, it goes full daydream and the room falls away into a kid's drawing of a race where the little racers are little angry faces like wah, 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 chasing after him. And
they're just zooming past him.
We go back to the classroom and he's still in the daydream as baby Trixie.
This sequence where Speed is just like going through this race, it's this shot where it just slowly rotates around him 360 degrees as he gets himself more and more lost in his daydream. And like, it's just this joyful little sequence. And also, I'm going to make maybe the deepest Looney Tunes cut I can make on this podcast, which is, this is a Ralph Phillips cartoon, specifically his first appearance in From A to Z. And the Z turns into a little snoring sound effect.
Well, Mr. Phillips, daydreaming again?
But like, this is wonderful. I adore this. As someone who grew up on a steady diet of Calvin and Hobbes comics, this is the shit.
In the real world, he's sitting at his desk making noises like, yeah, yeah, like muffled racing car sounds.
Speed, go.
Oh my god, he's like Joey in the shower, except there's no guns.
I had that very thought, yeah. And except he doesn't suck. Little Speed is great.
And as Lucas mentioned, we see a young girl. She looks back at him, doesn't look quite judgy, just like she notices him. This little girl will become very important later.
The second the bell rings and the teacher is explaining everyone has to turn in their sheets and there is the homework, he has grabbed his bag, grabbed his paper, slammed it on the desk, and he's gone. And the teacher has to yell out, "Speed Racer, slow down!" But it is too late.
Never.
Never slow down, Speed. Because Rex is there to pick him up. This is his older brother.
It's his big brother.
And this is our first look at the outside world, too.
And he's there in the Mach 5.
It's the Mach 5! It's the car!
So this is not just, hey, my big brother's here to pick me up. This is not just, hey, my big brother's going to pick me up and we're going to do something cool. My brother is here in the coolest car on the goddamn planet. How is a Scantron test going to hold this kid's attention? I swear to God.
And my big brother is the coolest person on the planet because he's racing in that car and maybe I get to race it.
There's no comparison. The car wins.
And Anna, you were talking about the neighborhood. This neighborhood is the most CGI neighborhood you've ever seen since Pushing Daisies. And it's actually much cruder than what we would see later in the episode because it hit me as I was watching this for the first time. This is Speed's memory of this event. This is not an actual recording of the event. And as such, everything that is not him and Rex and racing looks like de-res. It looks like the, you know, the background of a Minecraft video.
Oh, you're brilliant.
Everything is really cheap looking.
I didn't even think of that. You're so right.
Because he doesn't give a shit about that. Because he's in the best car in the world with his hero, his brother Rex. Why should he care what the houses he's driving past look like? They're de-res because processing power is being used somewhere else and it is in that car.
And honestly, one of the other major things here, the way this movie is shot is it is one of those movies where everything is in focus at all times. You are rarely ever going to get a rack focus or anything that is in the foreground or background that does not have the lens on it. Like, everything looks super flat because of the aesthetic that they are going for with this pop art thing. So the fact that, like, anything is something that just skims off your eye at all is a significant and conscious choice.
I think that's really interesting choice given the color grading of this movie, too, because the color grading makes Lazy Town look like it's black and white. It's so bright, so vibrant, and all these colors that we're talking about, they're not washed out. They are at maximum saturation. Every house, every car, every person's clothes is just a kaleidoscope, and combined with the flat focus, really, really makes it look like someone has hand-drawn it or has animated it for a cartoon.
Yeah, it honestly works so well. Either maybe it's just the choices of colors and how they complement each other, or maybe it's just the conscious flat look. For some reason, this works really, really well in a layer where if I try to look at the live-action Grinch movie, it makes me feel like physically queasy, and only part of that has to do with the fact that Ron Howard decided that the camera needed to be moving and jilting wildly in every single shot.
Oh, no.
So Kid Speed wants to go racing with Rex. He wants to go to the track, and Rex is like, nah, it's not a good idea. You know, you are a 10-year-old. You probably should not be in what is the equivalent of a Formula One car. But then all of a sudden, he kind of relents, and he says, did you wear the socks? Speed pulls up his pant leg, and you see that he's wearing, like, red knee-high socks. This will be explained later. But then Rex says, all right, well, if you roll us again, it'll be the last time. So, again, Speed drove a car and rolled them over. He rode off a race car at the age of 10.
We're not talking about some kind of, like, I don't know, rolling the engine, like cycling it. The vehicle did a 360. The vehicle itself rolled.
You gotta say, Rex is not the most responsible older brother in the world.
No, but that does make him the coolest.
Oh, absolutely. Gosh, I wish I'd had a brother like him.
Speaking of the coolest, Rex has got Speed in front of him in this non-Mach 5 race car, a red T180 that we'll see later, Rex's kind of track car as opposed to the Mach 5, which is his regular driving and rally car. And they are whipping around what I can only describe as a wipeout track. There are jumps, there are huge ramps off to the side, and every time they go over, they drift and spin. And there is something about the wheels in this movie, the wheels of specifically the track cars, not the rally cars. They can drive in any direction. It's like they're a ball.
Yeah, what you have to understand, people, is that this is Mario Kart. Everything here is going to work by Mario Kart rules if they didn't have items.
Some of them do. We'll get to that later.
There is so much spinning. Cars will go from moving super fast to spinning in place like tops, still moving in that same direction super fast, never slowing down, and then somehow straightening out again without shearing completely in half.
There is a certain logic to this because Rex has Speed in his lap as they are driving together, and Rex gives him advice as they're driving on the track, and he says, close your eyes and listen to what the car is trying to tell you, which in any other scenario, no, do not close your eyes while you're in a moving vehicle. Do not close your eyes while you were driving the car. Do not do that.
This is not the trench run.
But here this works. Because remember the Yu-Gi-Oh rules? Rex is going to tell you to close your eyes and believe in the heart of the car.
It's not a dead piece of metal. It's a living thing. It is going to get you across the finish line. You got to feel it. And I'm remembering Jean-Luc Picard being able to feel the engine of his Enterprise being off through the deck plates, or Vimes reading the street from the paving stones through his boots.
Oh, yeah.
It's that.
It's that kind of thing.
We also use this moment to establish a character called Ben Burns. He's an old racer, a former champion, and he drove the final lap of the Vanderbilt Cup with his eyes closed. That detail's not important, but what is important is that Ben Burns exists.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't catch that one. You're right.
Yeah. They're building more of the lore of this world, of what is important in this world.
Yeah.
And then after this happens, after Speed thinks about this, we do a cut back. We have this quick shot of Speed still with his back to us, putting on his jacket and taking a worn photo of Rex with him from his locker. And now we are on the racetrack, which basically is like a whole bunch of Hot Wheels rolling around a 7-year-old's dream car track.
Oh, we skipped past the sickest smash cut, though. The way that transitions between the two timelines is...
Yes.
The way it cuts is... Rex and Speed are about to go over a jump, and Speed has to decide when to hit the boost. And he says, wait for it, now. And then he hits the car's boost power, and it goes over the ramp. And the car flies into the camera, and then you see 20 other cars fly into the camera following. The scene changes to night, the racetrack changes to lit up. And we are now in the middle of a massive race.
This track looks like Rainbow Road, like the hard Rainbow Roads from Mario Kart. It fully rules.
Yeah, this is Thunderhead, and we're going to be here a few times in this movie. I never get sick of it. It's so cool.
Yeah, this is basically the professional racing track that also just seems to be in the racer's backyard, essentially.
So Speed is racing, and throughout this, we are constantly getting updates from various announcers from around the world. And if you speak their languages, you will get more information. For example, I got a bit from the French announcer, and they say that Speed Racer is eating up the track. Let's hope he does not make the mistakes his brother made. More on that later.
This is also the sequence in which we establish the visual language of a lot of what they use for the announcers throughout the film and the rest of the rides, which is, as Lucas mentioned earlier, you essentially have these headshots of them slowly pan across the screen, and there is a scene transition that they carry along behind them like they're a banner or something. Or you have these sort of heads that just keep floating past as they cross from the left side to the right side or the right to the left. As they have overlapping bits of dialogue, it's a really, really visually interesting and engaging way to do announcers like this, because usually it's hard in sports movies to cut back to these announcers in the box and have them still feel dynamic, because they're just sitting there talking about the thing you're watching. It's like when the Z-Fighters all just sort of stand around gritting their teeth and putting their hands into fists and talking about how powerful Goku and Cell are somewhere over there.
Yeah, no, you're right. They keep things moving quite literally, even when you're looking at the announcers. Oh, the announcers don't move because they're boring. Okay, cool. Make them move physically.
Yeah. And that's how they often do a lot of, like, cuts from one shot to another, too.
They'll float ahead past and use it as a wipe. The only modern movie that I've seen do something similar is a Tony Scott movie called Unstoppable, which is a great movie with Denzel Washington and Chris Pine about a runaway train. And they use news reports to give us information on what's happening constantly, because it's an emergency and it's being tracked by multiple 24-hour news helicopters. And so anytime that you need something that a character is not actually experiencing, you go to the news footage, and then you have people in, like, the headquarters talking about what they just saw on the news to give more information.
Oh, that's smart.
It's incredibly, like, meshed together. It's that's a great so cool. movie. It's one of my favorites of Tony Scott's.
Oh, that's really nifty.
Then we meet Sparky. Now, Sparky is the kind of pit boss mechanic, the 2IC to Pop's racer who builds the cars. Sparky is the one who runs the race through Speed's earpiece. Sparky is played by Kit Gurry, who is an Australian actor. Hey, Anna, you ever watch Looking for Ally Brandy?
I came so close to watching it, but I never actually saw it myself.
Okay, well, Kit Gurry was the cool counterculture boyfriend in Looking for Ellie Brandy. Oh. And he was also in an Alex Proyas movie called Garage Days that only I watched because it was set in Newtown. He is a guy who's been around in Australian stuff. And I guess he must have met the Wachowskis when they were in Sydney or something, because there was no reason for him to be in this movie. He lives in Australia.
There's a surprising number of Australian actors in this.
So he is talking to Speed and he points out a gentleman by the name of Snake Oiler. Yes, all the names are like this.
They're all like this. I assume these are names that had to have been established in the original dub because Snake Oiler, that's great.
Some of them are, but some of them are not. Some of them are new for the movie. I actually watched a few episodes of the show to kind of get up to speed. Snake Oiler is one part of the CAT, which is the car acrobatic team, under his leader, Captain Terror.
Captain Terror. So many of these names just slipped right by me because this is such a visual movie, not really a dialogue movie. Holy crap.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, Snake Oiler has like snakes around his steering wheel. He has a snakeskin helmet, snakeskin vest.
Yeah, this dude looks like he's about to go take down G.I. Joe.
It's not just a snake skin helmet. He has a snake mounted on it.
He looks like Sacha Baron Cohen decided to do a cobra riff.
Oh, you're so right. Oh no, you're so correct.
You expect him to be wearing an all-over print Gucci shirt and white jeans and little loafers.
Oh, you really do.
It's too correct.
Blasting hard house for no reason. Snake tries to ram Speed, but Speed uses his favorite gadget, which are jump jacks. They are four sort of pylons that launch out from just below the axle and four points at the bottom of the car, and they bounce him up into the air, and he can use them to do flips and respond to things. Jump jacks are to Speed Racer what the Expelliarmus spell is to Harry Potter. They are his favorite thing, and he will use them in so many ways throughout this movie. And yep. Whoever designed this effect loved it because it has the precision and punch of hitting a key on a mechanical keyboard. It's chunk every single time.
Also, it feels like everybody just kind of keeps forgetting that Speed's car can jump. The car can jump. The car just jumps a lot. Other cars jump too, but it feels like there are so many times in this movie where people just try to do something that would normally get a car that could not jump, and they're like, oh shit, I forgot, Speed's car jumps.
And Snake Oiler does forget.
I think my favorite thing about the effect is that whenever you see it from underneath, because you quite frequently see it from underneath, the feet are glowing red hot. The feet on these pylons spray sparks everywhere like metal pulled straight out of a forge. It's amazing. Somehow, the simple act of punching off the ground superheats these pylons.
Well, they're also traveling at like 300 miles an hour.
And they also had to make sure that this was like visually distinctive because there is a lot of noise in this movie. There's a lot of visual noise happening at all times on purpose. But they really had to do something to make sure that when you saw Speed's car jump, not only because it's the white car so it stands out, but also you got to make sure that you can tell that that thing is jumping.
Yeah, they use a lot of slow-mo for the jumps.
Yeah, and Snake Oiler forgets that Speed can jump. And so he crashes his car, and we get to see what happens when someone crashes. You see his car disintegrate around him as he screams of rage, and the cockpit is suddenly filled with bubbles. Brightly colored bubbles.
He just sort of floams up.
And they form into a ball, kind of like a super ball that you'd get out of a vending machine. And he is ejected clear of the crash and bounces away. This is the Wachowskis telling you, don't feel bad for these car crashes. Everyone's going to be okay.
Even the bad guys. It's fine.
It's how they keep the PG rating.
It's for kids. It's a movie for babies, right?
It's based on a cartoon for children. So, like, we're not going to do some grimdark shit here.
Yeah, they're not going to get splattered.
Well, speaking of some emotionally powerful stuff.
Yeah.
Sparky looks at the lap timing and just quietly, this is one of my favorite bits in this movie. This was the bit I turned on to, and then we had to watch again to have the context for this bit. Because Sparky realizes that Speed is doing so well, he's approaching Rex's race record on this track.
Yeah, and he doesn't even, like, say that out loud.
He's just like, holy cannoli.
You know who you're racing, right?
So you flash back to Kid Speed through Speed's face, and you hear him say, my brother is the best racer in the world. Everyone else is racing for second.
Ugh, gosh.
And then we get some Mario Kart shit because one of the announcers gets handed a bit of paper with this information, and he says out loud, and I'm tearing up a little as I say this, Speed is chasing the ghost of Rex Racer.
And they do this incredibly cool visual effect that, again, Mario Kart shit. If you've ever played a racing game where you're trying to match a speed run or any kind of, like, record, you usually have a ghost that you're chasing. Like, another version of your sprite, of your car, of your Mario, of your guy that is running ahead of you, essentially doing the perfect run of this. This is happening on the racetrack in the movie. Probably as a metaphor, not like a real ghost. But it's extremely cool.
Yeah, but here's the thing. Speed is next to Rex's ghost. Because Speed is not following the same line that Rex is following on the racetrack. He's going to do his own thing, but it's just as good, if not better.
When it comes in, it fades like he's inside Rex's car. Like his car is inside the hologram, but then they start moving apart and they start to dance and weave, passing through each other. It's beautiful.
This is the point where we cut to the stands and we meet John Goodman as Pop's racer. He's great. He has an incredible mustache. But he is with, and I don't know what y'all think about this, but in my opinion, the worst part of this movie, he's with Spritel and Chim Chim.
So these are, again, characters from the original anime. It's Speed's little brother, and it's Speed's little brother's monkey pet, who's a chimpanzee named Chim Chim. They are in this movie a lot, like a lot. And honestly, I never quite catch Spritel, and I never really know how to spell it. So this kid is just named Squirtle in my notes.
Doesn't have the sunglasses, though. This is one of those things where when you're adapting something, sometimes the flaws of the adaptation are the flaws of the original. Because while, yes, they are a chain and weight around the neck of this movie, they are also very prevalent and popular in the show. Everyone loves the little kid brother and the hijinks he gets to with his monkey. But they suck. They suck a lot. But you know who doesn't suck? You know who doesn't suck? Trixie.
It's Trixie!
We meet Trixie for the first time, played by Christina Ricci, with the most dramatic fringe I have ever seen outside of a Kamen Rider movie.
Yeah, she's got the bob, she's got the bangs, it's a whole look, she rocks it, and also she watches races with opera glasses.
She also flies a helicopter, she's kind of the race report person from the show, but she's constantly like in and out of the cars and helping out the racer family.
If you've ever seen, for example, Scooby-Doo and the Reluctant Werewolf, a movie I hate yet I'm utterly compelled by because it is just so unrelentingly awful. You know Shaggy's girlfriend who just shows up in that movie and is never anywhere else and has no explanation for how she is there? She is simply there. I think her name's Googie, which sounds like a slur. She drives a helicopter with Scrappy-Doo because, of course, she and Scrappy-Doo hang out. That's what she is. She's the Trixie.
Continuing this flashback sequence, we meet Kid Trixie, who is currently listening to, I swear to God, a posh Australian child whose name's got to be something like Bryony or Arabella.
Oh my God, you're so right.
And I've got the line here because it comes straight out of any mid-aughts Australian sketch about Australian private school kids.
Oh, you're so right.
My daddy told me that his daddy used to work for Machida Motorworks before he quit. My daddy told me that he was a completely crazy thing to do. He says the whole family is crazy. And then Trixie pipes up and she goes, well, Speed's not crazy. Nah, he's just dumb. The dumbest kid in class. At which point she starts to echo out as Trixie goes to the angry place. But then... This Delta Goodrum played my birthday party ass kid from Turak getting dropped off in a Bentley. Call Speed the hard R slur. And tell you what, you say the hard R slur, you are going to look real funny eating corn on the cob with no fucking teeth because Trixie knocks her out.
Yeah, Trixie beats her ass, but good. Correct. That is the only correct response when somebody says that word. Holy shit.
It is the perfect establishing character moment. Also, I gotta point out, this is one of the very few scenes in the movie where the background is out of focus.
There you go. Because again, we're in Trixie's memory and she's remembering the emotion of the moment and the joy of beating this dumb kid's ass.
At which point then Speed, who is in a little go-kart, and Trixie catch each other's eye and start crushing hard on each other immediately, prompting Speed to immediately say the most compelling and romantic thing that comes to his little like 8-year-old brain, which is, you want to see my car collection?
We can't talk about Theodore Rex again, Annie.
That's after Speed gets distracted while making hard eyes of her and crashes his toy car. And Trixie runs to help him.
And when we say heart eyes, the shot goes out of focus and the bokeh dots that you would normally see when something's out of focus with lights behind it are literal hearts like they used a Petzval lens. So, yeah, the movie knows what's up. These kids are in love.
They're 8 years old and they have the biggest crush.
One of the things that I think about with Trixie a lot is one of the observations that Jay Edidin made in his essay about a trans speed racer is that Trixie doesn't really like cars the same way Speed likes cars, but she likes how much he likes cars. Like, she really digs that passion and enthusiasm for this kid's hobby, his hyper-focus, and she really loves that about him, and I respect that tremendously.
She just likes to listen to him info dump, you know?
Yeah, tell me about it. Tell me about your thing.
Yeah, Speed starts info dubbing about cars, and she puts her chin in her hands and smiles dreamily.
So she rides on the back of Speed's go-kart as they go home, and they see Rex and Pops, who are working on an engine. And Speed gives Pops a package from, quote, a big fan. But when Speed describes his car, Rex looks really scared, hears the box ticking, and in an incredibly complicated thing, grabs him up, breaks it off, locks the gas down of Speed's go-kart, throws the package into the go-kart seat, allowing the go-kart to wheel back into the street, maybe about 3, maybe 5 yards, at which point it explodes and everyone is safe. Rex, you could have just thrown it.
Yeah, but we also had to spend a little bit more time with Rex in just a tank top with engine grease on his perfect face and his big arms and sweaty and hi.
How you doing there, Annie?
Hi.
Everyone is horrified by the bomb exploding except Trixie, who is in utter awe and says, oh, cool beans.
Like the fire is lit within her eyes.
She's like, I'm hanging out with this family forever now.
Stuff's never boring around the racer house.
No kidding. And this is when the announcers back in the race in the present start talking about the tragedy of Rex Racer. And then we start to figure out what that is through a series of flashbacks.
Yeah, they say he ruined racing, he dishonored his family, and we see that Rex is leaving and he stops to visit Speed's bedroom and give him the keys to the Mach 5. And Speed treats it like he's just been handed a letter home by a guy about to get into a B-17. Like, no, this is your car.
Speed's like, can I come with you? No, this is your car now.
Ooh. As he hugs him and he looks at him, and here's where they turn up the trans allegory thing real high, okay? Because Rex leans down and he looks Speed in the eyes and he says, Speed, one day people might say things about me, but I hope you never believe them. Because Rex is quitting Racer Motors. And Pops has that classic fight by the door and he calls him a sellout. And he says, you're walking away from us. You walk out that door, you better not ever come back.
Like, he basically acts like Rex is betraying them all.
And Rex, it's rough. And, like, you can see John Goodman is a good enough actor that when you see those words leave his mouth, he is still angry, but he wants those back.
Mm-hmm.
And Rex leaves, and Rex does not come back.
We take a quick dip back to the present where we do one of those, like, pan wipes with a character bust thing where we go back to Speed's parents. We see Mom, Susan Sarandon, as she is clearly remembering this as well.
They remember watching the news when Rex joins Uniron Racing and starts racing dirty. He is specifically taking out other cars rather than trying to win the race.
He drove for 5 years in the criminal underworld.
Also in this scene, not to derail, but Susan Sarandon is wearing a top I'm very gay for. Not that I'm not always gay for her, but this particular top. I am but a humble lesbian. Fight me.
There is a lot of, like, really good, like, mod 60s, late 50s, early 60s looks in this movie.
It whips ass.
And it is all on purpose. God, women had some good looks back then.
They really did.
So Speed is watching this, and as the newscaster says that Rex nearly killed someone, he nearly took his head off as his car went over him. And Speed is watching in tears, not just that it is his brother, but it is a thing about, as a kid who grew up immersed in a sport like hockey, when someone's favorite player is caught doping or with steroids or something.
Yeah.
And it's that hurt of a little kid of like, I believed in you and you did something that makes me not be able to do that anymore. I've heard it being referred to as someone's first heartbreak.
Yeah, it's that, shoot, what's that word that we have to put up on the big shelf because the Tumblr kids keep talking about it? Forming an attachment with someone else,
Oh, wait, no, it's about jumping out of a plane with someone else. Oh, it's parasocial. That's the one.
Parasocial.
There we go.
It's a parasocial relationship, which is a totally normal thing to form with, like, a sports hero or something like that as a kid. It's that kind of thing.
Cut to a POV shot of Speed as he is punching towards the camera. And unlike the violence that Trixie did against Bryony from the North Shore, tears are running down his face. He's furious, and we are seeing it from the point of view of his victim. This is him being angry and lashing out. And what we see is he's punching another kid in the face because that other kid, who inexplicably is from New Zealand, says, I told the truth. His crumb bum brother doesn't belong on the racetrack. He belongs in jail. At which point Speed vaults the teacher and tries to break his face.
Speed's got some anger in him, it turns out.
Mm-hmm.
And also, nobody's allowed to talk shit about his brother. How dare you?
Also, this kid he beats up is dressed like Spritel from the show.
Oh, yeah, really? He is, isn't he?
So then we have more announcers talking about Rex's indictment, and Rex goes to trial and gets indicted, and this brings down a racing powerhouse called Uniron, which is linked to a race fixer who's in jail now, who is rumored to be responsible for the crash where Rex vanished. Rex getting charged really, really shook up the racing industry world.
And we also learn about, like, the point in which Rex Racer actually dies. Because he was on a race that will actually come back here later in this movie. He was in this incredibly dangerous cross-country race in these incredibly dangerous ice caves, and there was a horrible cave-in. It was all over the news, and Rex died. That family lost their eldest son. Speed lost his older brother and his hero and his icon. So not only had his legacy just stained racing forever, but also it was a tremendous loss to the family because that kid is never coming back home ever.
You lost your chance to make up with him, Pops.
Mm-hmm. Mm,
sorry.
And this scene is introduced with a very incredible shot. It looks like a large glass sphere is coming towards the screen. And then it shatters and you realize we are looking at a bottle of liquid which has been shot from underneath and Mum Racer has just dropped it in shock.
That's right. Oh, I love these transitions.
Yeah, it's beautifully done.
So many scenes in this movie are shot from underneath. It's incredible.
Yeah, and it's landed on the coffee table and it's spilled juice everywhere and no one cares because they are all reacting to the news.
But back in the present...
So Speed is back racing the Ghost, and they are side by side. And just as they get into the final straightaway, we see Speed, who has been entirely focused on looking forward and racing, glances to the left and looks directly at the Ghost of Rex. And right at the very last second, he taps the brakes. So by 1/100th of a second, Rex's record still stands.
But he still won the race handily. Everybody is excited about this thing, except for a strange shadowed character watching from beyond.
As the camera floats through Matthew Fox's eyelashes, we are revealed him as Racer X. And his girlfriend says, he's good. And he says, no, he's going to be the best if they don't destroy him first. Hey, guys. Can I?
Uh-huh.
What's up? Yeah.
I think that guy might be Rex Racer.
What? No. You think?
Can I tell you folks what they do in the cartoon whenever Racer X turns up?
Yes,
what?
Please.
4 to 5 times an episode. Every episode. They say, look, it's Speed's older brother Rex in disguise as Racer X.
What?
Just in case, because it's really subtle. Don't know if you're going to pick up on this.
Oh, that's so funny.
Like, I thought it might have just been the episode that I was watching, but no, it's in all the episodes.
Oh, God, yeah. Here's the stuff that I love about Speed Racers because of that lip flap. Like, we were still trying to figure out what to do with lip flap dubs at that point. And so, like, that's why some people just talk so really, really fast all the time. Just gotta get into the lip flap. Just gotta get in that amount of time that the mouth is open to really say the whole sentence. Or other times that they'll just have really weird cadence. My actual favorite example of lip flap is actually from Speed Racer X, the late 1990s/early 2000s. remake of Speed Racer, which they only had like 12 episodes in the States, but there's one point where a woman confronts Racer X, and the script did not really account for the lip flap very well. And what happens is a woman accosts Racer X and says, "I know you, your name is Rex. Rex, 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 Rex." They had that whole extra set of syllables to fill, and they just said Rex a lot.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
Oh, that's very funny.
You also find a lot of lines that end in ha ha.
Oh, yeah, yeah, exactly. Ha! Hoo!
Oh, my goodness.
Speaking of which, if you ever watch the episode of Dexter's Lab where they do Speed Racer, that's why they do this. And also, yes, Dee Dee was combined with Racer X and Trixie and Spritel.
Oh, that's so much.
That's so much.
That's a lot.
Dee Dee's already a lot.
Dee Dee's already a lot.
So speaking of things with bad lip flap and some questionable animation.
Here we go.
Spritel and Chim Chim are watching some pretty terrible fake anime in their jammies.
See, I haven't seen the Speed Racer anime, and I actually thought this was from the Speed Racer anime.
Oh, God, no.
Until I realized that fidelity of the lines was too high.
No, no. This is like the idea of what Dragon Ball Z looked like to an adult in like the late 90s who had it described to them by an excited 13-year-old.
Oh my goodness.
But yeah, there's like a bit of Berserk in there, and yeah, there's like a bit of JoJo in there, and it's lots of big grotesque figures with giant weapons, and then Spritel and Chimchar start mouthing along with the terrible dialogue.
And Chimchar?
Oh, no, it's not a Chimchar. I actually realized I wrote Chimchar in my notes.
Squirtle and Chimchar.
Squirtle and Chimchar. That's them now. It's lore.
Yeah, it's Squirtle and Chimchar.
Squirtle and Chimchar.
By the way, in this scene, I will say one good visual gag that is completely lost to time at this point is that Squirtle is wearing Paul Frank pajamas that have like the Paul Frank monkey on them, yes, that graphic.
Yeah.
And then you cut over to Chimchar, who is wearing the same pajamas, but with a little boy on them.
Little human heads, little human faces.
Yeah.
That made me laugh aloud and startle my cat.
That's a good bit. Actually.
Really good bit.
Speaking of a good bit, they're jumping on the couch when it cuts back to real life. And Mom Racer goes by and says, "What are you two doing?" Spritel says, "Nothing." "Was it the same nothing that broke my last couch?" "No, that in fact was a totally different nothing."
But the whole family breakfast is interrupted because there is a tremendous sound that may be an earthquake. It's ridiculous. It's coming from right outside the door, and there's a knock at the door.
Oh, yeah. Actually, just before this, Spritel is screening Speed's calls because so many people calling after the big race to try and recruit Speed onto their team. But see, you got me doing it now. Squirtle says,
"Just accept it, Lucas."
Nah, he's not interested and hangs up. And like his mom is like, "What? That's for Speed." And he's like, "Mom, we know what's going to happen. He's not going to leave Racer Motors. Come on."
He's got a race for Dad. It's probably worth noting that the apparent age gap between Speed and Squirtle seems very much like the same age gap that was between Rex and Speed, which means that these parents have children at very odd intervals, frankly.
Yeah.
And Pop's Racer during this breakfast makes one of those comments that your dad starts to make when he gets a bit older about the sponsors controlling the media. Here, he's factually correct.
Yeah, it's like actually dead on for the theme of this movie.
The so-called earthquake turns out to be, this guy named Royalton just landed a jet on their front lawn.
And by the way, if you didn't figure out that his name is Royalton, don't worry. It's on everything. And also, yes, Royal, what color is that? What color is associated with royalty? Purple? Good. Put it on everything, including my hairspray.
His colors are purple with gold trim.
Mm-hmm.
His jet plane is purple.
Yeah, his entire jet is purple except for the grill, which is gold, and the wingtips that are gold.
Mm-hmm.
This is some Saints Row shit. It's so good.
Yeah.
Yeah, so he plies them with fancy cigars for Pops and weird genetically engineered flowers for Mom because they're going to bloom 3 times in 3 different colors here for you. And then he invites himself to breakfast because, is that pancakes I smell? And a figure like mine needs constant attention. And same.
He's rich, but he also understands pancakes. He's approachable. Also, y'all, this is a man who has worked in the stage for a while. This is played by Roger Allam, but it's okay because you don't know him by that name. You know him as the originator of Javert. This is Javert from Les Mis. This is the guy.
Oh my God.
Oh, really?
Yes. Huh. Well, this how is about the that? Original Javert. He's even like,
Lomaine, you wear a different chain.
Thank you. The important thing is that this guy is like a Broadway legend to the point where, like, I mean, they do those like 10-year anniversaries of Les Miserables, and like he's in there. He's on that microphone. He's the guy that everybody's attempting to match with this like legendary musical.
Well, that definitely explains how he manages to chew the scenery in every scene, whether or not he's talking quietly or loudly.
This is a stage guy.
Every scene he's in, his presence is incredible.
Yes, he is playing to the back of the house, and he is doing it amazingly. You can always tell a Broadway guy because they're playing to the back of the fucking house, and they know what to do.
Your boy putting dents in the back wall.
Hell yes.
Yeah, so he sits down to breakfast and he's eating the pancakes, and he even speaks in German that pancakes are love. But here's an establishing character moment.
Oh, I really need your recipe for pancakes. It's wonderful.
But she says, oh, yeah, I'll give you the recipe. And he goes, no, I want to buy it because I want to patent it. I'm going to turn it into a line of products. So that's this guy. Right there. There's your few sentences. He takes a thing he loves and he buys it because he wants to own it, and only he can have it.
And like, there is a version of that where it is like, I want to pay you to make this a mass product, but also I want you to like own this and have the royalties to it and be recognized for your art, etc., etc. This is not that.
So then he decides that he's going to butter up speed because he was watching the race, and this was no mere driver I was watching. This was an artist. Remember what I said before about how it's about making movies? This is the studio head picking an independent director out and saying, you make me love movies again. Come to my studio. I want you to work with me. And Spritel tells him to kick rocks.
But he's also like, yeah, that's not going to stop me. You're a small child. I don't actually care about you. Speed. Let me seduce you with money. You've got a wonderful team here. I don't want to break up your team. I just want to own your team and own you.
I just want to help you guys.
I want to help you. You know, my company is also like a family. Because, you know, whenever somebody says we're not a business, we're more of a family, that's a good sign.
That's definitely a green flag, and it's not a reason to run screaming.
Yeah, green flag. It's a checkered flag. Beep, beep.
Oh, you're so right.
I mean, most of us don't trust that because we have families. And we know what they're like. So he also tries to, reminiscent of some dickhead who bought Twitter, tries to present himself as a self-made man. Oh, I was a self-made man with a Commodore 64 in my foster family's basement.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like, you see, Pops Racer, you and I are the same. Yeah. We're both just independent guys with a dream.
You know what I always trust implicitly? It is when someone tells me that we're not so different, you and I.
So they all get on the plane to go to Royalton Industries.
To meet his family.
There's candy on the plane. There's a trolley full of candy, and Squirtle likes candy.
Yeah, it's going to be plot significant, sort of.
Barely. And a flight attendant offers Squirtle all these lollies and says, you can have as many as you like. And there's this angel singing hallelujah bit. And then his dad's like, you and Chim Chow can have one each.
We get off this plane. Everybody's in purple. The whole building's in purple. Everything's in purple. And we go on a big fancy tour that involves so many segues. And I'm not talking about transitions from one scene to the next. I am talking about the little two-wheeled, like, go-kart thing that people thought was going to revolutionize walking for a while there.
Yeah, right up until the guy who built them then got killed riding one.
I didn't know that. He got killed riding his own invention?
He was testing an off-road Segway, and it threw him so bad it killed him.
An off-road Segway?
Oh, no. That's terrible. I shouldn't laugh, but I'm laughing.
At which point, as they say, interest dried up.
Oh, holy shit, is that what happened? Oh, goddamn.
So as they're going through this tour, Royalton is showing them this, like, incredibly complicated assembly line that can put together a car from raw firmament to finished car in 36 hours. And he kind of goes, oh, how about you, Puffs Racer? And Sparky has to say, yeah, it's a couple of weeks. It takes us a couple of weeks to build the car.
They also talk about how he has, like, this assembly that creates or manufactures something called transponders, which is basically what makes the cars in this one go. It's the magic car juice.
It's the applied phlebotinum.
Yeah, and he says he's the only one who makes those except for Musha Motors. More on that in the future.
Mm. Also, they have owls in their hyper training facility for drivers. They test them in any environment, and also owls.
Yeah, there's drivers doing gymkata. There are some in the centrifuge. There's people being shaken, being frozen. Hey, it kind of sucks to be a driver for Royalton.
There's one in, like, piranha-infested waters. This whole scene from the factory to the training areas looks, again, like something a floop from Spike has designed.
Also, I definitely need to take a moment here because this is the point where I was really able to zoom in on it. The Royalton logo is a big R in a circle. It also has a small registered mark of the little R in the circle, which is... Beautiful. Chef's kiss.
Oh, that never clicked for me. I thought it was Royalton Racing, two R's. I didn't realize that it was Royalton Registered Trademark. That's so funny.
That's real good.
And horrifying, but funny.
As the seduction continues, they literally drive through a door hidden behind a painting by Nicolas Cousin of The Triumph of Pan, a.k.a. a painting of a bacchanalia. And they open up to a fancy bar where all the drivers are drinking and picking up hot ladies.
It's a casino, even. There's, like, blackjack tables.
It's gone from a factory to a fancy cocktail casino party.
And they are still driving in their little car that gets you from one part of the airport terminal to the other.
That is purple. Not the ballroom. The ballroom's normal. It's the most normal-looking area in the whole factory.
Yeah, they shot parts of this in Germany, so it's probably a real building, that one.
Hell yes.
One of the few real buildings in this place. But Spritel recognizes Cannonball Taylor, who's the 5-time Grand Prix champion. And he walks up and compliments Speed, and Speed is starstruck.
Oh, man. He's like, oh, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Cannonball.
And he points out to the trophies, and he's like, you want to win. And then he points to Royalton and he says, you need this guy. And then he wanders off to drink some more and gives Speed a significant look as he leaves.
The family continues on to, of course, arrive in a gigantic, beautiful penthouse apartment that can all be yours if you only sign.
Royalton even refers to them as taking care of their thoroughbreds properly. Once again, they were family before. Now you're horses?
Mm.
Yeah, also, this is the house from the second Incredibles movie.
Yeah, it's that same kind of, like, beautiful, like, 60s style, like, lush, just great shit. I love this design aesthetic so much.
Join the dark side. We have penthouse.
We also made you a suit, because when Speed stepped off the plane, the first thing they did is they measured him, and nothing was made of that. And then in the space of maybe 30 in-movie minutes, they've presented him with a pretty nice purple suit with a Royalton logo on it.
He looks sharp. It is really well tailored.
It is a good suit.
Yeah, I mean, Emil Hirsch is a good-looking guy and in great shape. This accentuates all of it. It's a plush-looking suit. And then Royalton, feeling very smug from his position of power, leans over to Pops Racer and he goes, hey, what do you think, Pops? And Pops speaks truth to power.
Oh, man.
And says, I am more intimidated than impressed because you have too much money.
When somebody gets that kind of money, they start thinking that the rules that apply to everybody else don't mean squat to them. And it's like looking directly at the camera into the year of our Lord 2024. Jesus Christ.
And he holds the gaze with Royalton. But he says, it's Speed's decision.
He says the only thing that he's really, truly proud of is his sons, as well as... Is this the part where he says that and marrying his best friend? Was that the part where
yes.
he said that?
Yes, it's the cutest thing.
Right? He says, there are two things I've done that I'm really proud of. One, marrying my best friend. Two, having my sons. And I will do what it takes to make sure Speed has the best opportunities. So it's up to him.
Yes. Yes, he married his best friend. Yes. Thank you. Like, this married couple, like, Pops and Mom, they don't get a whole lot of time because, you know, it's Speed's movie. But that is just a beautiful little moment. I love it when that kind of thing actually happens on camera.
Yes. Oh, that's so good.
And so Speed wants, like, a little bit to think it over. But Royalton says he wants an answer now. And he gets just the barest bit intense where he's just like, People don't make me wait for things. I want to know right now. And Speed is going to say no, but Royalton backpedals and says, you know what? Take the weekend. We'll meet early next week and we'll talk it over. And then as they leave, we get a close on Royalton and we cut to a beautiful young man getting beaten to a pulp.
This is a guy named... Okay. So we have a couple of Japanese characters in this movie, and their names are never going to make sense. This is, as the characters in the movie call it, this is Taijo...
Taijo Togekan.
Yeah, this is Taijo Togekan, but Togekan is spelled with a K-H-A-N. There are choices in here, but you know.
Do you recognize this guy, any?
I didn't look this actor up, no.
Well, he's not just an actor. He is a K-pop idol.
Oh.
His name is Rain. Huh. He is Stephen Colbert's nemesis.
Oh.
Huh.
Rain, my K-pop arch nemesis. A man who takes cruel pleasure in beating me at things.
Which is also why in this movie, we get so many scenes of him in like an open silk shirt. You know, being beaten bloody, in a tuxedo, soaking wet, bare-chested.
And he's Korean.
Yes. Extremely Korean, this Japanese character.
Great.
It's...
Great.
Fine.
If you want to see him in a real bad movie, you can watch Ninja Assassin. He looks great in it. It's not a good movie.
That's a weird... Okay, but that's like a weird move for a... I mean, we're going to get more of this family later on in the plot, but like, it's weird to have that in your movie that is based on a Japanese property, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. There are people who are much better equipped to talk about the Asian representation in this movie than we are, but it's not... great.
It's not spectacular.
I was going to say, I mean, the lady who plays his sister, who's also meant to be Japanese, she's Chinese, so it's at least it's across the board.
How about we talk about where they are instead? Because they're in this old-timey office, which is insane contrast to this futuristic world.
And he's getting punched in the face by a bunch of guys who are in bowler hats.
These are Cockney gangster stereotypes with giant sideburns and drawn-on beards and bowler hats. And they're the goons of a guy named Crusher Block, who is from the cartoon.
These guys just exude, hello, hello, hello.
The boss wants to speak with you.
These guys seem like they're about to kidnap 14 spotted puppies.
Oh, it's not Crusher Block, it's Cruncher Block.
Oh, yes, Cruncher Block. There you go.
Yeah.
And he is basically beating on Taijo because he's like, you thought you could walk away from our arrangement. And gee whiz, kid, when you get in bed with crime, it doesn't actually work like that. You don't get to say when it's over. And so he then obliquely threatens Taijo's sister. And he's like, look, you know, you screwed around with us and we would normally put you in concrete shoes. But I have a better idea because he has a piranha tank in his office.
You know.
It's just behind his desk. It's fine.
Yeah, he's just got some piranhas.
He calls it his babies.
And he's like, why don't we have them eat your hands?
But first he has to throw a gigantic, what appears to be a gigantic sweet and sour chicken leg.
A massive leg of something sticky.
And he throws it in and they skeletonize it. And he's like, don't worry, it only hurts for a few seconds. Then you black out.
And he's about to have his goons stick this kid's hand in the piranha tank. And then he gets interrupted by a phone call.
From an old rotary phone.
A phone call from the driver. That's right. They're in a car.
Yeah, she's like, we have a tail. And they're like, oh, check it out. And then a bunch of goons open secret hatches in the side of what ends up being a semi-trailer. Because, of course, in Speed Racer, they're in a semi-trailer office doing crimes.
And you'd think they would have, like, nodded to this by having, like, the water move around or, like, a little, you know, some characters react like they're on a train or moving or something. No, they have played it completely straight that they are in a room up until the point where we find out this room is being tailed. And I have special information about this truck.
Oh, let's go for it. Hit me.
Tell us.
There is a two-part episode called The Race with the Mammoth Car in the cartoon.
Okay.
So... you know how this is like a semi-truck here and it's like got like a armor and missiles and big wheels and stuff? So in the cartoon, the mammoth car is a literal train on wheels.
Wait.
Oh.
It is 200 yards long. The tires are 5 times as tall as the Mach 5.
Oh my God.
The main engine has 7,500 horsepower. Every wheel has its own engine of 1,500 horsepower for a combined 30,000 horsepower.
This sounds like something that chases down Furiosa in Mad Max.
That is the coolest thing.
I'm putting a couple of pictures into the chat. Oh, and please. You can react in real time to the mammoth car. All right. There you go. It just dropped in.
Oh.
Look how big this thing is.
I love it. It's so stupid. Beautiful.
That's the dumbest thing I've ever seen. I love it.
And they race it in something where it's kind of like the Neverweight Open Championship, which is that anybody from any weight class or any car can race. So they roll up in a train. Like, what up?
I mean, why not?
So then, the reason for this train, and this is when you said Goldfinger before, mm-hmm. and this makes sense, it's because Cruncher Block stole $50 million worth of gold, and so to get it out of the country, he melted it down and made a car out of it.
Oh my god.
This car's made out of gold?
Solid gold.
Oh, that's beautiful. No wonder they need that horsepower.
Yeah, I was about to say, you'd think that. I did a little bit of math. This is like my nadir on this episode. So in 1968, gold was worth $43.50 per ounce, which is times about 36 tons of gold to be $50 million. So 36 tons, a 400 horsepower truck can pull that much.
Huh. Lucas, I love that you did math for this.
I know, nobody needs this, but it's so great, isn't it? It is one of the enduring images of Speed Racer, this giant fucking train Lucas, chasing down the Mach 5.
Lucas, thank you for giving us this little glimpse into the math of you.
Oh, you said the thing! You said the thing!
I said the thing!
Oh my god. So, here's a semi-truck, which could probably pull 36 tons of gold, but it's...
Oh, yeah.
Being chased by Race Batman.
Yeah, Racer X is here, and he is going to take down this semi to rescue Taijo.
And everyone starts to freak out. They're pulling paintings off the wall and sticking guns out the windows, and they're these very fitting the gangster image. They're very old-timey weapons, like grease guns and puppeteers and Tommy guns.
Oh, these are like Tommy guns and stuff. It's great.
Yeah, except Racer X is behind them, and they're all just shooting out the sides wildly because they are that worried, except for Cruncher Block. Anna, do you want to say what Cruncher Block does?
So Cruncher Block goes to his desk, and a big console with joysticks flips out of the desk, and Cruncher Block uses it as a monitor to lock onto and fire missiles at this car with a big target lock that turns into an angry face.
This dude's got joysticks that look like he's ready to play TIE Fighter on, like, a gateway computer.
He's got a rocket pod built into the front of his road train. This movie rules.
This movie rules, actually.
Oh, but the important thing is that he doesn't hit with the missiles because the car uses jump jacks to spring over them.
Bana bana! But to show that Racer X is not speed, his response to that is to flip a pair of 20mm cannons out of the bottom of his car and rake the entire mammoth car with it, blowing huge holes in it, including one in the piranha tank. Which is the only thing that worries Cruncher Block, because they're his babies. You there, over there, plug this with your finger. And the dude looks so scared.
Not that this matters to anyone else, but it looks like, in what feels like a similar nod to the old-fashioned guns they got for the mobsters, it looks like the cannon that the car number 9 has like Bren guns turned sideways and stuck onto each other, and this only matters to me because I know the shape of the magazine is very weird.
What the f*** is that? It's me Bren gun! How do you think you could have bought something a little bit more practical?
It's just such an interesting little thing that they were like, hey, let's buy a bunch of World War II guns in bulk. We'll use these ones for the old-timey ones, but then we'll modify these other ones to use them for futuristic purposes.
What the f*** was that? Well, that was the Bren gun!
By the way, in the background of this scene, the goon who had to stick his finger in, it gets his finger eaten by the piranhas as he thrashes.
The missile pod is at the front of the truck, and Racer X has turned his car around and is firing back, but there is a shot which is in slow-mo, bright blooming red filters, everything is silhouetted, where Racer X is firing his machine guns as Cruncher Block is firing missiles, and they're exploding in the center as all the shots collide.
Oh, yes.
It is the coolest thing I've ever seen in my life.
Yeah, and the explosions get closer to the truck as they go, showing that Rex is winning. It's the way you do that beam of war thing you see in cartoons, but it's good. It's real good.
Yeah, yeah.
Cruncher Block tells the driver, hey, pull over, but don't slow down. And they said, screw this, actually. We don't even care about this guy. And they throw Taijo out the back of the moving truck.
And once Taijo is thrown, Racer X does stop and save his life. And Taijo's like, oh, thanks. And Racer X is like, screw you. You need to help me, like, get evidence to get rid of this cartel. You're on Cruncher Block's leash. And Taijo's like, I don't waste my time with justice. And Racer X kicks him out of the car, like, pulls over, kicks him out of the car, and gives him a business card that's like, hey, win you lose in the next race in Fuji, give this a call if you're still alive.
If you're still able to hold a phone.
And that just drives off. Yeah.
Yeah.
What a great line.
Yeah, you're real tough, but these aren't kid stakes, pal. A fish did nearly eat your hand about 20 minutes ago.
Also, they talk about this next race being in a place called Fuji, which I fully do not know where this is supposed to be. Is it supposed to be Fiji? Because it's not the mountain.
No, they say Fuji, and it is a track race like Thunderhead.
Yeah, it's somewhere tropical.
Maybe Fujifilm sponsored the stadium.
Could be.
It's possible.
It's the Fuji Instax Bowl.
But we're jumping ahead a little. Before we get to that, we cut back to Speed and Trixie, who are on a date at Inspiration Point. To quote the words of Funky Winkerbean, which nobody's ever actually said out loud and is not a real thing, it's a, quote, solo car date.
Yes, and they are surrounded by these, like, hedges of, like, camellias and stuff. So it's, like, red and green, and there's petals floating, and it's very romantic. Speed is thinking about cars.
Obviously.
Of course.
And he's, like, at some point, he's like, when I'm behind the wheel of a car, it's pretty much the only thing that makes sense. And Trixie, who is in an incredibly fetching outfit with, like, a halter top and, like, a vintage look and everything, she's like, oh, that's the only thing that makes sense?
And they actually float a bit. Like, it's actually kind of cute floating.
They have such cute flirting. Speed at some point promises essentially to someday he wins the Grand Prix and in front of a crowd just screaming their heads off, he's going to dip Trixie and kiss her on the mouth, and it is adorable.
This flirting is something that actually took me back as I was thinking about it. It's coached in about 5 different euphemisms because these kids are still teenagers. They can't just say, hey, I like you and I think you're hot. I would really love to make out with you sometime. They have to couch it in, oh, well, you know, you don't pay attention. Oh, sometimes a girl could use a reminder. Oh, you mean like a new igniter for your helicopter? Ooh, no. A tire burn spells out your name? Ooh, warmer. And then he gets to the kiss. And they're about to practice for said kiss. Bless them.
And then...
Wet Spritel is the worst.
Because you know how in Speed Racer, the cartoon Spritel and Chimchar were just hanging out in the trunk of the car all the time? Womp womp.
Yeah, because he's mad that they went to Inspiration Point to be gross.
Because kissing is gross.
Oh, and by the way, get a cootie shot while you're at it, guys. This is a funny joke I'm making.
He's awful. Let these children make out. Let these teens make out. God damn it.
Let these hot people have fun.
Although when they rouse on him, they do get out of the car and we see Richie's full outfit and it is a halter jumpsuit with short shorts. And like I said, I am but a humble lesbian.
We were all correct as millennials to have a crush on Wednesday Adams is all I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
And like I said before, the red of this outfit is the same red as the number 5 on the Mach 5. She picked this. She Pantone swatched this motherfucker.
She loves that Speed loves cars. And she is going to do her damnedest to make that association, to make it even easier for Speed to be like, oh no, this makes sense too.
Yeah, this makes sense. I'm going to kiss this.
I can't kiss my car full on the mouth because my car doesn't have lips. But she does.
So we cut to Royalton, who is making a deal with guy I love to see, Hiroyuki Tanada, from lots and lots of stuff, including the new Mortal Kombat movie.
Nice.
He's great.
It's so great to see Tanada and stuff.
He's so good.
I never realized how many things he was in until I started to take notice of him as a character. I think I first really grew to recognize him from Westworld. But after that, and seeing that he was in everything, it made me really happy. I love him.
Speaking of which, he's real handsome.
He is.
He's a good-looking man.
If I had to pick a dude.
Nobody has to. It's okay. He is the head of Musha Mortars, who was mentioned in the earlier scene as the only other company that makes the transponders that Royalton makes. So Royalton makes a deal with him and said, I get your transponder foundries if I give you Togekon, because you hate Togekon's dad. And so if I give you the son, then I get my transponder. And when someone wins a race with our car, people make big money. There will be more on this later.
You're going to have to just figure out at some point that stock prices are going to come into play as a plot point in this. And that's a little more complicated than usual for a corporation storyline. But, you know, we're going to roll with it.
I honestly think that's why they use Spritel for so much, because Spritel is the reason kids giggle at this movie. And they have all the really difficult talky bits interspersed with Spritel being a jackass. I think that's mostly to keep children's attention.
This is the hard bit of the plot that you got to get through.
Yeah, because we have all this while Squirtle and Chimchar are like sneaking into the factory and having joy rides, having sugar rushes on the airplane, killing people on Segways.
It looks like a Wolverine got into that candy cabinet.
We're not quite up to that yet. This is the next day.
Yeah, so the reason he got there is that Speed went back to Royalton. And Royalton has taken the liberty of making up a Royalton's Racer Motors logo made up. And Speed doesn't like it. He's like, because the R for Royalton is much bigger than the R from the Racer logo.
Mm-hmm.
And it's emblematic, isn't it?
Yeah. And like Royalton's got all these contracts ready to sign and all that.
You can help your family. This is the best thing for them. Because Speed's saying, look, my family's really important to me. And you know, I've only ever raced with my dad. My dad's only been independent. Royalton is putting on the full, you know, join me and we can rule the galaxy schmooze on him.
And Speed starts to talk about why it is so important that his family races together, because his family fell apart after Rex died. And there's this really, really interesting scene that he talks about as like this pivotal moment with him and his father, where his father just shut down completely after Rex died. Until Speed, as a little kid, finds him one night in the middle of the night watching these old racing videos, like these black and white films. It's the 43 Grand Prix.
So they were watching this tape together and silently, and then in the very last lap, Pops just starts to cheer. He gets caught up in the moment and he starts to cheer and scream, and then Speed gets caught up in the moment and they cheer and scream together. And as Ben Burns crosses the final finish line, fighting his way there, they cheer together and they hug, and that reignited their passion for racing.
This is the same Ben Burns they established was a family hero earlier in the movie.
And Speed even says, in my family, racing is a religion, and sponsors are the devil, so I say no.
And Royalton immediately drops the act.
You could say he switches gears.
And just calls him a poor, naive chump.
You child. You sweet summer child.
With that sickening schmaltz.
Here comes your fucking wake-up call. Meanwhile, this speech, this incredible speech by the guy playing Royalton, is cut with Spritel stealing a car, Spritel drunk on candy, Spritel in a trench coat with Chim Chim on top, trying to sneak away from guards. Because here is this incredibly intense speech by this villain who says, hey, you see these five rich white men? They created the racing industry and the racing league. And you know that nice memory you had with your dad? That was manufactured drama to drive a stock price up, prevent a takeover, cause a merger, and create a monopoly. Racing is fixed, you fucking child. And all that matters is power and the unassailable might of money. The true heart of racing is stock prices, and that's my religion.
Ugh.
And meanwhile, we're driving out people on Segways. Bam, bam, bam. Oh, let's pretend we're an adult by sneaking in with a lab coat. Ooh.
But of course, I put the monkey on top.
Oh, no, we got caught.
They're playing air guitar.
And Freebird is playing. Literal Freebird is playing.
And then we have 5 seconds where Squirtle sees something in like the car manufacturing set, and he points out a spear hook, which we have no context for and will not get context for until the very end of the movie.
All we can see is that it is a machine that goes out from underneath one car, reaches out with claw hands, and grips the bottom of another car.
But considering that we have cars that jump. The audience has no context that this is a different thing or a bad thing, aside from the fact that Squirtle sees it and he's like,
he reacts like he's just seen a gun under someone's jacket. It's meant to be dangerous. So then we go back to Speed, who chucks the suit back to Royalton in a plastic takeaway bag. Just like, here, I don't want this anymore.
Yeah, this is the paper bag that he brought with him. It's great.
And he says, well, look, I'll see you on the track. And Royalton says, I promise you.
You won't even place.
You won't finish.
He literally says, I know you're about to go to Fuji and try to prove me wrong. And as we do that, we pan across to Speed, who is now in his racing helmet. And this is a time skip transition to Speed on the racetrack at Fuji, trying to prove him wrong.
And also Racer X is here in the race, taking out other cars, and the announcers note him as the harbinger of boom, because explosions happen.
Oh. It's the worst.
This track is insane. It is like a double helix spiral all the time.
There's a cowboy racer named Billy Ray who crashes with Taijo, because guess what? Taijo doesn't win either.
Yeah, they told him he wasn't going to finish.
There's also a car called the Gray Ghost, which has nothing to do with Batman, unfortunately.
Doesn't even sound like Adam West.
But notably, one car gets right up beside Speed Racer's car, uses that quote-unquote spear hook we saw earlier to reach under his car, lock onto it, and then spins both their cars out while they're stuck together to crash him, so he gets a did not finish.
Despite all of the jump jacks and other things, it's shown that blatantly offensive attacks in a race like this are incredibly illegal. So what they do is they lock up close to him to make it look like the two chassis have locked together, which can happen in a race. And then he spear hooks under him so he can't get away, and it's a way of wiping someone out, which they do to Speed. And the Mach 6 that he is racing at this point, because the Mach 5 is the road car and the Mach 6 is like the track car, gets completely annihilated and destroyed.
And we cut back to Royalton here.
Royalton is continuing to speak as we've had our cutaway to the race and we've seen what's happened to Speed.
Royalton cuts back and basically tells him exactly what's going to happen, which is that this race is going to be such bad publicity. There are now going to be litigations against Pops's designs. So Janus Automakers is going to sue Speed Racer's family for IP infringement. And even if these are spurious, and even if they're thrown out, it's going to completely ruin this family because they're a small, dependent group. This is pretty much the only time that they would be in the spotlight here, unless they were also talking about Rex and the bad publicity he brought to the family. And it's basically going to ruin them forever. They're not even going to be able to pay the legal fees. They're sunk.
He is still laying all of this out to Speed, as is like he's laying down his cards to say, I have a hand you cannot beat here.
Yeah, he does not take a no very well.
At the end of the meeting, Spritel is caught, and so Speed leaves to take him home. Spritel, of course, flips off Royalton because precocious children.
But he is also right to do so.
Yeah.
Yeah, that guy sucks.
He is right in every bit of animosity he shows against Royalton. He is objectively correct. He's just the worst as well. These two things are true at the same time, unfortunately.
You're not wrong, Spritel. You're just an asshole.
And now we cut back to the locker room at Fuji after the race, and Speed is just devastated. And then he gets a visit from a man that he instantly clocks as Ben Burns, his family's racing hero.
Yeah, and Ben Burns is played by Richard Roundtree, a.k.a. Shaft.
Nice!
Why do I keep coming on when Shaft is in a movie, Annie?
I mean, Lucas, sometimes these things just call to you.
Ben Burns is actually an announcer now. He's retired. And you see him at various points throughout the announcer montages. But Speed looks at him, and because he's had his illusions shattered, he looks at him and he says, hey, Mr. Burns, can I ask you, was the 43 Prix fixed? Did you know you were going to win? And Ben Burns sort of pauses for a moment. And then he says, you know, me and Stickleton, everyone thought we were enemies, but we were actually good friends. Anyway, see you. Good luck in the next race. And he leaves, and Speed is devastated.
Utterly gutted by this.
And what's interesting is that that is not necessarily a confirmation. That is an insinuation. But I don't think we ever actually hear specifically from anyone else other than Royalton what happened there.
So Racer Motors and Speed's reputations both are in tatters. Spritel wants to respond to this by mailing poop to journalists, specifically monkey cookies.
Understandable. Gross and unfunny, but understandable.
And Pops actually takes a more broad view to this. He's like, it's fine, the truth will come out. And Speed, who is disillusioned, tells him not to be naive, then goes up to his room, has a little bit of a fit, and tears down the Ben Burns poster.
And here's where Susan Sarandon really shines as
Mom. One of the best scenes.
Oh, man. This is our anchor point for the whole film here in terms of what theme the Wachowskis are driving at here. Which is not a pun, but you know what? I'm going for it.
Because Speed says, I messed this up. I messed this up by not taking the deal. And his mom says, that's stupid. You didn't do anything wrong. You wouldn't have been happy. And remember before when I said that driving is the equivalent to making movies for the Wachowskis? Because here Speed says, maybe my happiness doesn't matter. Maybe I just need to do business. And mom sets him straight. She says, racing is in your blood. Do you remember when Rex took you to Thunderhead and you rolled the car? Which we then flashback to Rex pulling up with a tiny cut on his face, a scratched up Mach 5, and Speed with a giant comical bandage around his head, missing his four front teeth and grinning like he's just won the lottery.
He's so excited.
Mom, guess what? We nearly died. And she says, when I watch you do what you do, it's like I'm watching someone paint or make music. I watch you make art. It's beautiful and inspiring. And I have to close my eyes because I am so proud of you.
And she is actually tearing up in this.
Everybody needs a mom racer.
Like she just says, sometimes I'm scared, but other times I have to start crying because what you do is so beautiful. And I'm so proud to be your mom.
And Sarandon herself is tearing up for this scene. It's beautiful.
It's so good.
This is the anchor point here, is that she directly says Speed is an artist with what he loves to do. And that art is more important than a corporate interest in his art. The fact that he does something that he loves, that he is good at, that he is passionate about, that in and of itself is the point. It's the whole reason to do it is because he loves it.
From a basic definition standpoint, that is the purpose of art. The purpose of art is to be made and to be art. You put money in and art comes out.
Mm-hmm.
Art should not have to make you money.
And it is all wrapped up in this pure, unabashed love for a child and pride in their efforts. And it's a lot, actually.
Yeah, I mean, you could easily like map this onto a child who works in a creative field being disillusioned and being like, maybe I should just go to business school and sell out. And this is the mom being like, no, this makes you happy. You need to do what makes you happy. Keep doing what you do.
Yeah.
Ah, God. It's good. It's a good fucking movie.
It really is.
Oh, shit.
Then, just as a mom racer says something good will happen, there is a knock at the door, and it's Racer X and Inspector Detector.
Which is a hell of a name.
Cop extraordinaire.
Yeah.
And we are brought into how there is just rampant race fixing going on in the racing industry. And Taijo, as we tie back to when he was getting smashed in the face by Cruncher Block, has been resisting, but he needs help getting the evidence or something to make this work. And don't you know it, it involves racing.
Yeah, he has the evidence that will expose Royalton, but he says, you don't get it unless I can win this race, because if I win this race, then my dad's company's stock goes up. I'm in good with my dad and I can go back to my old life and not need to be crooked anymore. So you need to help me with this, except for here's the problem.
There are no more races until the Grand Prix. And because that was the qualifying race at Fuji, both Speed and Taijo are not qualified for the race.
There is only one other race that will let you get into the Grand Prix, and it is not a legal race.
It is a cross-country rally called Casa Cristo, which the whole family knows because that is the race that Rex died on.
And we see Pop Racer get furious, and he gets very cold, and he is like, you are not sending my other son into that death trap. And rally racing is a back alley sport filled with jackals, headhunters, and thugs. No fucking way.
Because, you know, Racer X is also here and he participates in these. And they're like, hey, so why is he wearing a mask? What's up with this? And he's like, he can't take it off because if anyone knew his secret identity, they would be at risk from bad racing crime guys.
The Joker would kidnap Alfred or Jason Todd. We've all seen it.
right. Exactly.
Tim Drake will end up a mini Joker. It will be bad.
Oh, no!
A great movie, but a bad scene for Tim.
In this case, it'd be the woman with him, presumably his girlfriend.
Do we ever get anything on that lady? Is she just sort of there because...
She's a very hot and capable black lady, and we don't get her name.
Honestly, it feels a bit like that bit in the Josie and the Pussycats movie when they're like, well, I know why everybody else is here, but why are you? And she says, because I was in the comic book. And they're like, what? Huh?
Yeah, she only appears once more at the very end. No lines. Or maybe like one line.
So Speed and Trixie are back at Inspiration Point, and they kind of come to an agreement where they're like, we're gonna do this.
And it's raining. It's dramatic.
It's storming. There's lightning everywhere.
They're gonna do this, but they're gonna do it without telling Pops. And Trixie's gonna help from her helicopter and fully blackmails him into bringing her along. Because, dumbass, you're not gonna do this without me.
She's like, let me act as your spotter, or I will tell your dad. And you'll never leave his side again.
They come up with the alibi that they're going to go on a skiing trip to get their mind off things. So then we get to hear about Casa Cristo. It crosses 2 continents, 3 climate changes, and over 5,000 kilometers of track. So that makes this a slightly shorter version of the Paris to Dakar rally, which is where you start in Paris, running through the city, go all the way through Spain, Morocco, the Western Sahara, and Mali, and end up in Senegal in one race.
Cheesy crazy.
That is insane.
It is an endurance race, both for drivers and equipment. You have trains following these people with replacement parts because it is brutal. And that's, like, they don't even have things that shoot bees at you.
God, we'll get to that.
We are going to intercut here a couple of times with some shenanigans with Squirtle and Chimchar, who are trying to watch the race on TV, but hide that they're watching it from Pops. Just assume that it's happening a couple of times in the background as we go.
There is a really funny gag at this point.
There's exactly one good joke.
Do you want to take this one, Lucas, or shall I?
Sure. Whenever Pops walks by, Spritel changes the channel to a sitcom with a monkey.
Oh, yeah, this bit.
And Pops is like, what... What, it's in German. What are you watching? And Spritel kind of goes, not the monkey parts.
Oh, it's the only good chimpanzee joke in the whole movie.
And there's a lot of chimpanzee jokes.
Everyone accepts that a rally race is super dangerous, so the Mach 5 gets new defenses presented by Racer X's girlfriend, who says he gets a bulletproof cockpit, he gets tire shields, buzzsaw blades, crampons, and my favorite thing, a homing bird drone, which is directly from the cartoon.
Yeah, all of these are on numbered buttons, which in the original cartoon are just buttons around the steering wheel of the Mach 5.
Oh, that's what the camera's about, because the camera doesn't actually do anything in the movie, and it makes sense that it's from the comic now.
Because what they do in the cartoon is that drone, that little robot bird, goes up and is able to tell Speed in his cockpit what the race standings is, so where the mammoth car is, where Snake Oiler is in the mix. So that gives him a bird's eye view if Trixie's in the car with him, because normally she would do that from her helicopter. Because again, this is before GPS or computers. You're running a road race across a continent without even, like, you know, a map.
Yeah.
This is like a team sport here. We have Taijo, Racer X, and Speed are all on a team, and all of the other people racing are on 3-car teams, and they are all themed guys, like it is Wacky Frickin' Racers.
It's like the Warriors. But the thing is, they say, oh, most teams stay within league rules, except for there are some bad apples. And we immediately get cutaways of every car that is jam-packed with, like, guns, explosives, giant maces. It's ridiculous.
And they're like, oh, they don't cheat much, wink.
Yeah, there's a French announcer throughout the entire race who will find any excuse to be like, oh, no, maybe that's just a bit of altitude sickness. He wouldn't have taken a shot at the guy. No, of course not.
Oh, gosh, there's just so much dust. It's so hard to see.
So before the race starts, there are 2 bits of information that get conveyed. One is that Taijo is talking with a woman who is established to be his sister. This is presumably the same sister that Cruncher Block was threatening. He establishes that the race is important for family reasons, and and it's an emotional thing. Then we actually go over to Cruncherblock himself, and he's in, like, a lavish private room with women on his arms, and everyone's eating food. And there's Snake Oiler from the Thunderhead race whinging about how he was supposed to be fixed to win. Cruncherblock's like, stop whinging. There are better drivers on your team. They are going to win the race and they are going to go to the Grand Prix. But if you personally take out Speed Racer, your two teammates will drop out and you can have the fixed win and you can go to the Grand Prix. So now we know that Snake Oiler for Cruncherblock is going to be specifically targeting... Wait, is he targeting Speed Racer or Taijo? No, he's targeting Taijo.
And at the same time, Speed and Trixie visit a memorial, and it's like, it's fully a war memorial for those who gave their lives for this sport. And you'd think the name Rex Racer would look weird on, like, a war memorial, except for it's surrounded by names like Slim Silverton, Rocky Rubington, Cyrus the Virus O'Man, Clevon Delta, Velocity DeWitt, and Chucky Doo.
It's a racing anime, folks. We are here for one sport and one sport only.
Rex Racer looks like a normal name there. Like the most normal name there.
So our race begins with a dramatic, like, pistol fired at the light of the sun. It's great.
Fired by the Queen of Casa Cristo in a beautiful flowing red dress as she fires this, like, 1920s flare gun.
These are the Wachowski sisters being fully gay, and I love it.
It specifically says she fires the pistol the moment she sees the sun.
And that's the start of the race. And immediately, Speed is blocked in from the front, and a racer from behind tries to smash him into nothing, and he jump jacks out of the way. Barely.
And this is going to happen a couple of times. There's a big crunch right at the beginning as Speed is targeted by several different teams here. We're not going to catch all of their names, but we are going to catch all of their aesthetics. And we are going to learn in flashbacks what they were all bribed with to try and take out Speed Racer and his team.
Because it's all ridiculous.
Oh, it's so good.
Meanwhile, when someone tries to murder Speed Racer, instead Taijo is nearly blasted with a goo gun, and he drops back and ducks it, and another person gets shot in the face and then spins out. By the way, they're racing through the dwarf halls of Dwarodelph, in that there is a million pillars on either side of them stretching off into oblivion. There's no way anyone could race through this. You would all die.
We've got the flying foxes, who are sexy ladies who are paid in diamonds, because diamonds are a girl's best friend.
They have pixie mullets.
And they have pixie mullets. There are some World War II American soldier guys who are being paid in cash.
Cash from Eurocrat Bank. They have glowing bands across the money. And then...
God. And there are Vikings?
Oh my God.
Who are being paid in pelts.
They're called the Thorazine Corporation. Thor-Axine.
It's amazing.
And when we say they're paid in pelts, literally they are stuffing their face with sausages and ribs and stuff. And they walk in and they kick open a chest and it's full of, like, fox furs and stuff. And they all just start wiping their faces with it. It's extremely weird.
I also going to need us to take just 5 seconds to appreciate Trixie's outfit.
Oh, Jesus right? Christ. This is the one. This is the one.
Oh, this is the one.
This is the Lucas killer.
F*** sake.
This kills the man. This kills the gays.
It's true. No, you're right.
This is death to mortal gays.
Anyone who is into women is going to have a problem with this look. Somebody needs to, like, just run this one down for me.
All right, I'll get a picture. Hold on.
Yeah, we only see it like once or twice in a full shot. And one of them is, I think, like from sort of her like legs up. And it's like...
Yeah, so here
we go. Bisexual.
That sounds specifically Annie.
Okay, so it is... It is knee-high, high-heeled, black leather boots. It is a dress with a flared collar, no sleeves, extremely form-fitting, down to a purple checkerboard belt and short shorts, and gloves that go up to the elbow matched to a pink helmet. It's hot as hell.
It's so much. Christina Ricci. Goddamn.
And yeah, she is in her helicopter spotting for Speed throughout this.
So we have some, like, wacky racers chaos with a whole bunch of, like, some of the cars have, like, themed weapons, like, the Vikings have hammers on the bottom of their cars, a catapult with a beehive.
Oh, the beehive is incredible. And one of them has morning stars that he drags behind him, and he tries to forward flip to smash people or, like, cut in front of them to smash them. This is all, by the way, being played out in this very interesting effect shot where you see the continent unspooling under the racers as they traverse from location to location. It's like an evolution of that Indiana Jones red line shot, but you actually see them and it's being built underneath them as they race. It's really cool.
Yeah, so this is an action sequence that we cannot really, like, do justice on just, like, a shot-by-shot call here, nor do we think that would make for very good radio. Trust us that this fully rules. There is one point where a car jump jacks and, like, spins over to try and take out somebody with a weapon, and then Racer X jumps his own car up so he can connect his fist with that other racer's face and punch him square in the mouth.
It's so good.
Yeah, it's incredible.
This movie rules so hard.
And these are the bits where they really said, okay, what would someone with these gadgets do in this scenario? What could they do? And there's lots of like midair spins and kicks and people getting knocked out. Speed uses his buzzsaws.
Yeah.
His tire shields have to have a fencing match with somebody else's spikes.
Like, you know Ben-Hur with, like, the spikes on the spokes of the chariots? They do that. But what if one of the other tires had a shield to fight off the spoke spikes?
And they use thumbsticks on their controls while they're driving to have a duel.
This is so dumb. I love it.
Yeah, and Speed, who, by the way, has taken out the flying foxes, and he's sort of out of breath, and he says something to the effect of, haven't any of these guys read the rule book? At which point, one of the Vikings hammered nearly takes his head off, and he goes, this race is full of cheaters.
It's notable throughout this entire sequence that Speed and Racer X start getting in sync. They start working together really, really well, and Speed is going to notice this, and this will come up later.
Yeah, they're at the point where they're literally, like, juggling enemies between them as they bounce them off of things. They're working in tandem.
Unfortunately, none of this is good enough to get them to the finish line, because the first leg of this race, Snake Oiler and his guys win handily, and Taijo is pissed.
He's less than impressed.
He smashes their entire refreshment stand. Yeah. And I think part of, like, it's not said, but part of it is that because they spent all this time fighting and dueling their entire way across, whereas Snake Oiler could just put his foot down and go as fast as he wanted to go.
There's basically, like, nobody else in the race right now. It is just Snake Oiler's team and Taijo's team.
Racer X cools off Taijo and kind of sends everybody off to their room, saying a cop will be outside to be careful. And Speed tries to engage him before he leaves. He says, hey, we made a good team. It feels like we've done this before. And Racer X gives him nothing. He's like, hey, if you say so. And so Speed talks to Trixie and says, look, I think he might be Rex. You know, we buried a body, but it was really badly burned because the quick save had been disabled on his car. And a glorious sentence that I'm going to say as precisely as I can. Inspector Detector suspected foul play. God.
So fun.
At which point the cop knocks on the door and says, excuse me, Mr. Racer, sir, do you know these people? And he turns, and it's the whole family, and they're so mad at him.
Because eventually, Pops found out that they were watching the race on TV, and he was furious, and apparently the whole family hopped a plane to go get mad at Speed at the end of this first leg, which honestly disappointing, because Speed and Trixie seem to be, like, sharing a hotel room, and maybe there's only one bed.
Well, what if there was only one bed?
Only one bed, you say?
Only one bed!
What do we do?
This has all the vibe of you're out on a hot date, and it's not just that you get discovered before you can do anything cool, but your dad put the whole family in the station wagon to turn up and bus you, and now you're getting chewed out in front of your date, and it's the worst thing.
Pops is pissed. He is furious. He basically said some really awful things to Speed about how he's like a disappointment, how he is being reckless and stupid, and this is the race that killed his brother. What the hell is he doing?
And he's like, you think you can drive a car and change the world? It doesn't work like that. Remember how driving a car is making a movie? And Speed bites back. He says, the only thing I know how to do, and I gotta do something.
And finally, Mom is the one who breaks us apart and says, hey, look, bottom line, if they're staying, we're staying.
Yeah, because Speed invokes Rex, and everyone knows this is a no-go topic with everybody. And that's when Mom steps in and goes, hey, we are not doing this right now.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then Pops just stews, stares at him, and he's like, you added something to the Mach 5, and now it's all out of balance, isn't it?
And Speed kind of goes, yeah. It's like, yeah, it's pulling to the left, isn't it? Yeah. Come on, Sparky, we're going to go fix the fucking car.
Which is such a good, like, not apology apology.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I'm going to make this better so you don't kill yourself, dummy.
My stupid son who's so good at racing.
Okay, everybody shut up, because we got some honest-to-God ninjas.
Oh my God. Can you have ninjas in a movie that is based on a Japanese property that is also now full of white people? And Korean people and Chinese people who are playing Japanese characters? I don't know.
You know how I know they know what they're doing? They use the same assassination method from You Only Live Twice. He goes in the ceiling and he puts a thread down and he drips a debilitating poison onto Taijo's lips. Exactly like they killed Sean Connery's first Japanese girlfriend in You Only Live Twice.
And then Racer X, who appears in the middle of the room, ties a bandana over his nose and mouth so you can't tell who he is, and fights the assassin while shirtless. Hello, thank you. Thank you for this gift for me.
This is a good fight, too. The Wachowskis know how to shoot a fight.
And I swear they use some of the same choreography and techniques that they pioneered in The Matrix, too. It's great.
Yeah, it's good. It's like there's some slow-mo. It's not too gratuitous. There's some stuff, but really it is just two guys squaring off and trying to beat the snot out of each other in very balletic and beautiful ways. But then...
And then another assassin shows up in the racer suite where the whole family is asleep.
Sorry, he locked into the comedy room, not the martial arts room. We're going to get some goddamn hijinks.
Yeah, this isn't a cool fight. This is a funny fight. This is a comedy fight.
And it's great, actually.
It's weird at first, but it ends well.
The ninja is rumbled by Spritel, who had rolled off the couch and kind of groggily woke up and found himself face to face with a ninja, and they both scream. And then Speed gets to avoid the syringe of poison that was going to go into his face. Sparky tries to fight the ninja and gets, like, comically beaten. Like, he's, like, grabbed by the nose, grabbed by the fingers, and twisted into a pretzel. Spritel and Chim Chim try to do anime again. Like, they fly and they get, like, speed lines, which then results in them just, like, holding them on the legs. But then... Racer wakes up.
And, like, he grabs this ninja and it zooms in on Pops's hand where there is a wrestling team class ring, and the ninja goes, uh-oh.
Yeah, a state champion Greco-Roman wrestling ring. By the way, the ninja at this point has been punched out of his pants by Speed. He is in cartoon boxer shorts.
Yeah, Speed can do martial arts. Don't worry about it.
Yeah, and this is another thing from the cartoon. In the cartoon, Pops used to be a professional wrestler known as Dragon Racer, which is a killer name.
Oh, that rules!
Oh, that's awesome!
So, as you might expect, Pops Racer wipes the floor with this guy. He literally picks him up and destroys the entire room with him. It's like a Western bar fight. He, like, bounces him off the wall. He runs him down a table. He picks him up by his feet and swings him like Cesaro. Actually... this is a deep cut, and nobody will get this but me. The Rita Moreno episode of The Muppet Show, when she grabs that, the guy goes from a performer to a puppet, and she swings that puppet around through all the banister poles and stuff. It's that, with a person.
That's an extremely appropriate cut for I Will Fight You, thank you.
You're welcome. So all these ninja stars are flying out of this guy as he is being spun at light speed, including his car keys, which embed in the wall. At which point, Pops Racer stands him up in front of the balcony, and Sparta kicks him out of the building.
Not quite. He throws him onto a rolling room service cart, kicks that cart. The cart then goes over to the window and crashes and flings him out.
At which point Trixie says the sensible thing in the movie. Do you want to say it, Annie?
She's like, was that a ninja?
Pops dusts his hands off. He's like, more like a nanja. It's really terrible what passes for a ninja these days.
God.
More like a nanja just ruined me. It's beautiful.
This is Commander Vimes telling Willikins to go fetch that assassin kid out of the pond. They seem to have fallen in again.
Oh, I can get that reference now.
There you go.
And so this is the point in which they are interrupted by a knock on the door, and it is Taijo's sister. This is when we hear her name for the first time, which is pronounced in the movie as Haruko, and I can't. I hate it. I hate it so much.
Yeah, so...
Haruko. This is Horoko, probably?
Yeah, it's Horoko.
Which is a weird combination of syllables, but I guess we'll allow it. It was 2008.
This is the point when she brings us to Taijo, because he did get some of that drug in him. But okay, it's not a fatal drug. It just means that he's going to be out of commission for a little while and he can't drive. And they're like, okay, well, you can't drive tomorrow. And he's like, yes, I can. And they're like, no, you can't. So what are we going to do? We've got a car that needs to be driven. And the camera leaps over to Trixie, who looks like she has an idea.
The specific poison is identified by Racer X, who licks the needle of the dart they shot at him.
Don't do that. Don't do that, Rick.
And then identifies the poison by taste.
Iocane powder. I'd bet my life on it. So, yeah, so we start leg two, and Snake Oiler throws a literal cobra into the cockpit of another drive.
Like, catapults it.
He continues to be the worst.
We're in, like, the middle of the race now, and we keep cutting over to Speed, who keeps yelling over to Taijo's car, and he's like, this is ridiculous. This family is completely ridiculous. This is completely ridiculous.
Yeah, because Taijo's car is keeping up with Speed, but they're not working together. He keeps, like, nearly crashing into him and, like, is riding on the guardrail and stuff, and Speed is like, what are you doing? Keep it on the road.
We cut real quickly over to Horoko, I think, who is...
Yeah.
There's a fixer and some of his thugs to beat up Horoko to kidnap her.
Cruncher Block's goons are following her.
Yeah.
Because she's meant to be their leverage on Taijo.
Right.
Yeah, so she boards a plane wearing this massive hat, and Cruncher Block boards with her with his goons, and freaking in this futuristic setup, holds her at gunpoint with a World War I revolver and a gun. It's very contrasty.
They got those bowler hats. They have a commitment to an aesthetic.
But it's not Horuka. It's Taijo in drag. Tick one off your fangirl list. And it says, well, if you're here...
Well, who's driving your car?
Also, Taijo has just taken this debilitating poison and is unable to drive a car. But somehow he literally twists the Nagan out of Cruncher Block's arm and holds him up by the throat. And Cruncher Block is not a small man. So how does that...
Anything to get him out of the car. Who cares?
Yes.
Because it's very important who's driving the car. Do you know who's driving the car?
Who is driving the car?
Going in.
Trixie's driving the car!
She flips the visor back and her mascara and eyeliner has started to run. And she's like, I can't see anything in that.
She's looking butch as fuck in that helmet.
Oh, it's so good.
Taijo's outfit is a white leather driving ensemble with leather jacket and leather pants with embroidered black dragons that wrap around the legs and arms.
And it looks great on Trixie.
Yeah, combined with the smeared eyeliner and the slightly sweaty kind of fringe of her hair, it looks great. Also, just to get extra horny for a hot second, guess who's flying the helicopter in Trixie's outfit?
Oh, it's Horoko.
Holy shit.
Holy shit, she rocks that look.
Oh, wow. Okay, bless us everyone.
So we establish at this point they have two things they need to do. The first is overtake Snake Oiler. And there is a scene where Speed and Racer X disable some of Oiler's team cars while the announcers make some very strong double entendres. But then they establish that they have a rendezvous. They drive to a dead spot in the mountains with no cameras, where everyone pulls up, and another car has arrived, and Taijo is there.
Before we get to that, there is a moment where, when they're racing, and after it's been revealed that it's Trixie in the car, Snake Oiler nearly runs Trixie off the road.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
He puts her up against the guardrail, and she nearly goes over, and she's fighting it back, because she is a good driver, but this is beyond what she would normally do.
Like, she and Speed are doing this really cute bickering as they're driving, and she's like, you already say that I drive better than most of these guys, so I don't know what your problem is.
He's really worried, because this is not a normal race. This is the Casa Cristo rally, and you could really die here.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And when Speed sees that Snake has Trixie up on the guardrail, he punches Snake out of the way with his car, knocks Snake up onto the guardrail, spins his car backwards, and rides the front up onto the front of Snake Oiler's car, and holds his spinning tire 6 inches from his face as Snake Oiler begs for his fucking life.
It's so good, actually.
Angry boyfriend.
Angry boyfriend!
You dare hurt my girl.
How dare you? Boy Angie!
He's protect. active.
We love it when boy angry because girl is threatened.
But he doesn't hurt Snake Oiler. He eventually pulls away and Snake Oiler kind of spins out, but he's still on the road. And that's when they move to the rendezvous.
Once we get to the rendezvous, it's this big dramatic area. They all get ready to do this switch off because Taijo is basically recovered at this point. He can handle the rest of the race.
Plus, it has to be him who crosses the finish line because Trixie's not an official racer.
Right. And this is all going pretty smoothly until they get some unexpected guests.
Just before Block's goons arrive, because Block's been taken hostage by Taijo, and Racer X is saying things like, we should do what he would do, which is break his legs and make him walk back. Just for a moment, Trixie and Hurka swap part of their outfits. They like pass off the jacket back and forth between them.
Yeah, they do.
And suddenly Trixie's in a hot pink tank top and white leather pants with dragons on them with her makeup smeared back to her ear. And Haruka's suddenly in a halter top with Trixie's leather shoe. Yeah, sorry, Haruka, I should say. And it is still in stiletto heels. Everyone's hot. Oh my God.
Everyone's so hot.
They're so hot.
Oh, girls.
Indeed.
Girls.
Guys. Girls.
Yeah.
Girls.
Girls.
Just want to say that women.
Women.
Seriously.
Yeah. So Block's goons arrive and turn the tables. And so Block says he wants Racer X's mask. But guess what? Spritel's still in this movie. He hits Block with his slingshot. And what does he do, Anna?
He gets Chimchar to throw poo at him.
And it splats on his face.
But it's okay, because we're just about to get into an action sequence where everybody gets to do martial arts, including Trixie.
Mm-hmm. It rules. Like, Trixie and Speed are fighting back to back and kicking ass.
Which is pretty much the ultimate relationship goal.
Yeah, we need to talk about the way this fight scene is edited. There are cuts and wipes and all sorts of crazy angles, and the background is... So Speed Racer consistently has a background effect where it's blurred or otherwise patterned to show that it's not important where they are. What's important is that things are happening really, really quickly. And this is an example of that, but it's overlaid with the full complement of people moving across and getting flipped around and wiping across the screen as cuts.
It's a really fun action scene.
There's snow falling in the background.
Yeah.
And every time someone gets hit, it speeds into streaks for a second.
Like, if you've ever driven in the snow at night and you turn on your high beams and, like, suddenly it looks like you're going hyperspeed in Star Wars, it's like that. They use the falling snow for speed lines for action sequences like a manga panel.
It's great. And
it's really good.
Pop's Racer puts a guy into an ankle lock and taps him out. Although the only problem is that Sparky still had the switch on his back set to comedy fighting. Because he runs at Cruncher Block, and Cruncher Block just sticks his fist out, and Sparky gets knocked out without even being looked at.
Oh, Sparky. Oh.
He tries to fight another guy, and the guy just sticks the barrel of his submachine gun up Sparky's nose, and Sparky just puts his hands up and drops to his knees like, don't blow my brains out through my nose, please.
And there's a whole thing where he like tries to roll away, and the gun's still there, and he tries to twist around, and the gun's still there, and it's like, yeah, again, I feel like Kit Gurry got to set that day, and he's just like, sorry, man, I don't have it in me to fight. Can I be the funny guy in this fight? Everyone else is doing so good. Everyone's so cool and sexy in this fight. Speaking of sexy, everyone gets rid of their bad guys, right? And then everyone picks up a random gun that the bad guys have drops, including Haruka, who hooks it with the heel of her stiletto boot.
And then the sexiness has to dissipate, because then the chimp has to beat up a guy with a monkey wrench. See, because monkey, and because he's a chimpanzee, and apes and monkeys are...
And Spritel kicks the offsider in a dick.
Yeah.
So if he's beating up with a monkey wrench, does that make him, his fighting style, does that make him a foo fighter?
No. I thought you were going to go for monkey style kung fu, but you know what? You went in a different direction, and I respect that. So it stops because Block has picked up a gun, but then realized that literally everybody else who was still standing is pointing a gun directly at his face.
Again, fully rules, because it's a whole bunch of hotties.
Yeah. But here's the problem. While all of this extremely sexy and cool action has been happening, the rest of the race has been happening, and now Snake Oiler's team is ahead of them again, so everyone has to run to their cars.
Yeah, did they have a 10-minute lead on Snake Oiler's team?
Apparently. Yeah.
It's not easy to get a 10-minute lead on someone, although I suppose given the length of the race.
Trixie's good at cars.
Right. You know what? You're completely right.
Trixie is good at cars because Speed likes cars.
You're right. You know what? Forget I said anything.
We gotta get serious again, because guess what? We just got to the Maltese Ice Caves, because that's where Rex died.
And the entrance to the cave looks like a spooky monster with pointy teeth.
It's a big skull!
While they're within this cave that is entirely made out of glacial ice, you get tracers on all of the headlights in the same way you would if you held a shutter open on a camera. In a visually stunning movie, it is a visually arresting scene. It's so cool looking.
And like, honestly, the way they shoot all of the cars, well, the way they film, animate all of the cars moving throughout the sequence, it is all like sliding ice tricks. It is really, really cool looking. And it is very distinct from the way that they tend to do the rest of the racing sequences. It fully rules.
Even the road looks like it's made of a concrete lattice. Like, it's got grids on it. But that means that all the lights reflecting off the cars, because these cars are still covered in lights,
yeah,
just make this glitter kaleidoscope effect that is more subtle than the rest of the movie, but it's still incredibly visually arresting, as you said.
And Emil Hirsch, I'm sure this poor guy is sitting in a green coffin with a wheel in front of him. But he manages to communicate that, okay, I'm still going to win. I'm still a great driver. This is scary. And this is also scary because this is where Rex died.
Yeah.
And you can see that on his face because he has to do crazy stuff. Like, he has to put his crampons on and ride around the circular tunnel over the ceiling to catch up to Snake Oiler, who then drops a rainbow-tinted oil slick behind him because some things are classics for a reason.
And then Speed loses control of the car, goes off the side of the cliff, and you think he is going to die.
But then,
he drives down the cliff, puts out his crampons again, turns the car around, and drives straight back up the cliff around the outside of the Maltese ice caves. And just as Snake Oiler emerges out of the caves, Speed yeets himself up off the side of the cliff and lands on the road again, right next to him.
To his theme music from the cartoon.
Oh, it's so good! They don't use that theme all the time in the movie, but when they use it, it is to fantastic effect. It is triumphant.
It's like Indiana Jones stepping up from the minecart and he puts his hat back on. Ba 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 ba. It's like, yeah, it's on now.
And Snake Oiler cannot handle this. He's like, fine, I'm just going to shoot him with a gun.
Snake Oiler has a gun. Snake Oiler has a gun.
First he tries to speed, but then Speed jump jets over the oil because it's just a ground thing. It's a ground hazard. Ground hazards don't work on him when he's got his jump jacks.
Ground hazards can't hit you when you're not on the ground.
Exactly. And then Snake Oiler's like, actually, fuck this guy. I have a gun.
And he pulls out a gun, and the commentators, who, by the way, yeah, they're still commentating on this crazy race. One of them says, what's he doing with a gun on the course? And the French commentator goes, oh, I'm sure it's just altitude sickness. You know, the people do crazy things in the mountains. At which point, Snake Oiler tries to kill this poor kid.
But it doesn't work.
Because remember that bulletproof canopy?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Speed's got it pulled up. This is so good to actually see that get used.
And he is riding sideways on the wall of the mountain as Snake Oiler is shooting down into his cockpit, which is being blocked by the canopy.
It's so good.
So then, while on the side of this mountain face, Speed activates his jump jacks again, flips to the other side, does it again, and then checks Snake Oiler off a cliff. Movie wrap on Snake Oiler, you guys.
That's a wrap on Snake Oiler.
We see him get ejected from his golden car in his golden bubble from the, what is it, the quick save.
Yeah, screaming all the way because he's a petty little bitch.
He's not happy.
There's only 250 kilometers to go and there is nobody in the way. And they just win this race. Speed jumps out of the Mach 5 and does the thing with his little hand pose going up in the air and his little leg kicking out. And it's perfect.
Both in taking notes and in watching the movie, this is a huge win. and you feel like the movie could almost end here. This big set piece in the middle of the movie is the most fun and most drama we have had in this movie.
Yeah, this is a major victory until the next scene.
Yeah. Remember that thing that Royalton said? All of your memories, all of your joys, the victories you've had with your family have been entirely manufactured by me to make stock prices go up. Guess what?
The very next scene we have is Royalton getting in touch with Togokan, congratulating him on the race, and negotiating purchases at an inflated stock value.
Let's make a deal.
Usually it's just big corporation wants to smash out small business because big corporation, usually stocks don't come into play here. But this is a stonks plot.
The entire thing was a plan by Taijo to get back in his father's good graces so that he could be welcomed back into the family with this good stock deal.
Because line goes up.
We didn't explain it very well earlier, but Taijo didn't actually tell the Racer family that he wanted to do this for stonks. He said, I just want to go to the Grand Prix. If you help me win this race and I get the automatic invitation to go to the Grand Prix, I will give you this file on corporate corruption. It's only after the race is over that they learn that Taijo actually was only doing it for the stonks and was never going to give them the file in the first place.
He never even had the evidence.
And Speed is furious. He does the only thing that he knows how to do when he has too many feelings is he goes to race about it at Thunderhead.
While screaming. He is literally screaming at the top of his lungs while fanging it around this course on the Mach 5.
And they do a great Dark Knight of the Soul thing because the track is not lit. There are no people in the stands. None of the lights are on. It's just him in the dark with the safety lights and his car's headlights.
Except there is one other car on the track.
Dun, dun, dun.
Race Batman is here to talk about your feelings, Speed. And Speed sees him and he's so angry that he tries to blast him into the wall. And nearly does.
Yeah, and like Racer X spins out and Speed's like, oh no, oh god, oh no, oh no, oh no, are you okay?
Did I just kill him?
Did I get angry once and kill somebody?
And Racer X is like, yeah, no, it's fine. I'm cool. That was fun. How are you? How are your feelings?
He gets out of the car and he's laughing. This is the first time in the movie you see him smile.
How are your feelings, Speed? Let's talk about them.
And Speed just looks at me and says, look, just tell me you're Rex.
Rex, 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 Rex.
Yeah, I've seen you drive, man. Driving is how you express yourself in this universe. I've seen you drive. There's nobody else you could be. Take your goddamn mask off.
And he does. And it's not Rex.
It's Matthew Fox.
It's just some guy.
It's Jack from Lost.
Some very hot guy.
It's Jack from Lost.
It's just some very hot guy, but it is just some guy.
And you can see Speed take this like a punch in the stomach. Like, oh, it guts him. Because he was so sure. Yeah. But then Racer X says to him, look, I'm sorry. Your brother is dead, but I'm sure if he was here, he'd be proud. And Speed is like, well, so what? Nothing changed. And here comes the big old statement of the movie.
He looks Speed dead in the eye and says, it doesn't matter if racing never changes. What matters is whether we let racing change us. And that sounds like sports anime nonsense, but if you translate that a couple of degrees, it's great, actually.
Yeah, again, it's not about racing.
It's about art.
It's about art. It's like, you got to still keep doing what you're doing. You can't let the big machine grind you up. You've still got to do what you do. And he says to Speed, you don't do it to drive. You do it because you're driven. And that cuts back to what Rex said when Baby Speed was racing around Thunderhead. You need to stop steering. You need to start driving. You are not reacting to outside forces acting on you. You are directing the car to go where you want to go. And that's the movie right there.
It doesn't matter if there is a capitalist machine acting upon art. It is still important to make it.
This is a good movie, actually.
It's so good. Ugh, it's so good. Racer X says to Speed, you need to figure out why you race. And Speed says, why? And he's like, nobody can answer that but you. Why do you do what it is?
And he says, but I really hope when you figure it out, I'm there to see it.
Proud of him.
He's just smiling so much here because he just, like, there's just this joy on his face at seeing Speed and talking to him, which is so weird because he's just some guy.
Yeah, it's not like he's his brother or anything.
Unknown to Speed, this is his older brother Rex, who ran away from home years ago.
This whole movie, he has had a scowl the whole time, straight-lipped. Not mm-hmm. a hint of even, like...
emotion?
Amusement at something bad happening, like wry amusement. No wry amusement or anything. It's just neutral. But this is the first time he's shown emotion, and it's so genuine.
Speed goes home, and he gets his stuff, and he's like, he's going to leave because he doesn't know what to do. And he sees Spritel, and Speed and Spritel have the same conversation that Rex and Speed had.
To the point where Speed even hears his younger self asking, can I come with you?
And when I think it's Spritel, he says, you know, well, what do I do? And Speed says to him, you'll know when it's your turn, which is maybe the most depressing line in the movie.
Ugh.
Oh,
heartbreaking.
That cut deep.
But then what happens is he goes downstairs and Pops is there, and it's that echo of Rex leaving. And Pop, instead of yelling at him, calmly asks him to talk for a few minutes, that he's not going to stop him, but can they just talk for a few minutes first? And then he starts by apologizing.
Yeah, and he apologizes to him. He never said that this is it, but it's like he's talking to Rex. And he says,
yeah,
I'm proud of you. You stood up for yourself. And then Speed says, but it was meaningless. And he says, how could it be? I saw my son become a man. This integrity, this is a reason for a father's life. And then this is where the allegory of, for example, Rex being a trans kid or a queer kid.
God.
And he looks at Speed and he says, I didn't lose Rex when he crashed. I lost him right here.
When he walked out the door.
Speed, my door is always open.
Yeah, he says, I understand that every child has to leave home, but that door is always open. And he says he loves him.
And it's basically saying what every queer kid needs to hear, what they should get to hear.
That radical acceptance that Pops is man enough to say, I was wrong, I'm sorry. I have always been proud of you. Fuck me.
Yeah, no, it's good, right?
I fucked up one relationship with my kid, and I don't have the chance to fix it now. I am sure as hell not going to make the same mistake a second time.
I am breaking this cycle of trauma.
God!
And I am saying I'm wrong.
Oh my God!
It's incredible!
In a movie about race cars!
In a movie about art.
I hurt my other queer kid and I lost them. I am not losing you, you messed up little confused kiddo. You can always come back.
And there is this moment where Speed just stops. He doesn't turn around and leave. He hugs his dad and he says he doesn't know what to do.
He says, yeah, but it's a sham. And Pop says the smartest thing in the movie. Guy's a crook. Don't believe crooks.
Yeah, it's like we never get that absolute confirmation whether or not these races are all fixed, but Pops is just like, I don't believe that. That guy sucks.
Yeah, f*** that guy.
His whole profession is around bullshitting people. He's probably bullshitting now.
That guy sucks.
And this is someone who, since the start of his career, left a big company to start his own racing thing. He has hands-on knowledge with every aspect of the business. And he looked at that guy and he says, f*** that guy. That guy doesn't get it.
Yeah.
We get it.
And then there's this small noise and you find out that not only has Squirtle been watching this whole conversation, but the whole family has.
They kick Sparky out into the dining room and they make him tell him that, yeah, we were actually in here. We were all listening.
Correct me if I'm misquoting this, but I believe there's a moment where it's like, you guys were watching the whole thing and they're like, how could we miss it?
It's real important. Everyone's invested.
This is a family.
And the movie actually treats them like a family, like a unit, not like a person with these characters revolving around them, but someone who is actively supported and uplifted and affected negatively and positively both by these people who are a part of their life.
Yeah, even Royalton IDs it at the beginning of the movie. The strength of Speed Racer is the Racer family.
Yeah.
And yes, also Trixie is here. She basically just lives here too.
Yeah. You're only going to miss this.
Trixie and Sparky are fundamentally part of the Racer family at this point.
Yeah.
So the doorbell rings. And it's Haruko, incredibly dressed because she just snuck away from the opera.
She looks like a million bucks. She is in a gorgeous white dress.
Ugh, she's so hot.
She says to Speed, I'm sorry for what my family did, about what the Togekon family did to you.
I will say, all of the stuff that, like, you have to side-eye about the Asian representation in this film, at least nobody actually said the word honor, which I swear to God I was waiting for this whole bit.
I mean, she did say shame.
No, but she didn't say honor, and we have to at least take these tiny minuscule victories where we can get them, where somebody doesn't talk about their family's honor while being Asian.
Right. No, you're right.
Yeah, so she snuck away from her security and says sorry to Speed, and he tries to be cynical still and say, it's fine, it's another lesson learned. And she leans in and she says, it is they who are in need of a lesson. And then she gives Speed the invite to the Grand Prix.
She says that Taijo was not going to take it anyway because he already accomplished his goal. And technically speaking, according to the rules, Speed was a member of the team that received this invitation. So they have to allow him to compete if he shows up to the Grand Prix and presents this invitation.
This is your key to our final showdown, Speed. Go kick his ass.
And the family looks at each other. I believe it's Pops that says this. He's like, so how many hours did Royalton say he could put a car together in his little garage? 36?
36.
We're going to do it in 32.
Because that's why.
And we get a montage.
We get a montage. That's great. We intercut Royalton making a business deal while the whole family works together over the course of 32 hours to build a brand new car. And also, hello, can we spend a couple of seconds more with Trixie covered in engine grease and coveralls and a welder's mask? Just mm-hmm. sweating?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a lot.
Yep, we can.
Mechanics, though.
Please and thank you, we can.
Hello, mechanics.
Slight sidebar, if anyone was bothered by this, I only realized it on this watch through. When he says, we don't have a car. And my first thought was, it's a Mach 5. They were driving it around the track when he had his showdown with Racer X. And then I literally looked it up. And what it is that there's two kinds of car. There are the rally cars that are like road cars. And then there's the race cars that have the jet engines in the back that are single seaters versus the two seaters of the road car.
Oh,
and
yeah.
And that was the one that got written
and
off.
And that blew up in Fuji.
Yeah, it got written off at Fuji. So they don't have a car, which is why they don't even have time to salvage the chassis or anything. They have to build it from scratch.
Okay.
And they build the Mach 6, which looks incredible.
Also, we could probably slot in here, I believe, this is basically the Gem and the Holograms getting down to business when they build a new Indy 5 car from Holograms.
And Pops pulls out a dangerous forbidden technology called the Bernoulli Convergenator, which he says is faster than the converter that Royalton used. Which, by the way, Royalton signs the deal with Musha to get his new purple racer. It's the RCX with the converter inside. And it's a new technology that they have proprietary ownership of.
And Cannonball Taylor is going to be driving that car in the race. So we get to the Grand Prix. We get to everybody, all these people turning out, celebrating. Look at all these people rubbing elbows. There's an ice sculpture shaped like a car. And there's some kind of commotion at the entrance.
Because what's that? Is that Speed Racer's music? It's Speed Racer with a brand new car and an invite that says he gets to race in the Grand Prix.
It's basically a piece of paper that says I do what I want.
Not to worry. I have a permit.
So he's there with the Mach 6 and they try to stop him. An inspector detector says, this is a valid invite. If you stop him, I will have to investigate the whole thing for corruption and tear your companies apart. Let the kid drive. And now driving
in the 40th and final spot in the Grand Prix, it's Speed Racer in the Mach 6.
And Royalton brings up all the vile venom and rancor in his Javert-ass voice, and he says, $1 million to the driver who takes out Racer. And they put a spear hook onto the RCX.
And Cannonball's like, I don't need that. And he's like, fuck you. There's also this point where when Speed Racer is announced, we take this quick cut over to Horoko, who just sort of like looks very innocent while taking a big drink out of her bubbly. And Taijo glances over at his sister and he gives this tiny little approving smirk.
While their dad is looking on very disapprovingly. It's about the spear hook. Specifically, out in the rally races, weaponry, you could get away with it more because, you know, you were out in the sticks. But here, there are cameras everywhere. So the only way you can use a weapon is something like the spear hook that goes under the car. And this is a plot point.
Ah, yes.
It's the only weapon that they can covertly use on the track in front of the world stage.
Because there's an illusion of respectability at these races.
So before the race starts, we come back to Speed and Sparky, who get a little moment together, which is nice because Sparky hasn't really got that much time to shine in this film.
Sparky looks at Speed and Speed is looking nervous, and Sparky gets close to him and he says, "Hey, you know, it's a big stadium, but the cockpit is the same size as it was at Thunderhead. And I'm looking forward to that cold milk because it's a kid's movie. You can't drink champagne at the finish line. You drink a giant bottle of milk."
I think that's actually a tradition.
That's a real thing.
Really? Go figure.
Yeah, that's a racing thing.
It's a tradition from the Indy 500. There was a racer who used to drink buttermilk when he won or something. It was like his... That's right. He used to drink buttermilk when he was training. And some dairy companies were like, they didn't notice it was buttermilk. They just thought it was regular milk. And they said to this driver, "Next time you win, if you drink a bottle of cold milk on the winner's stage, we'll sponsor that." And it's since become a tradition that every racer, when they enter, they put in a preference to say what kind of milk they'd like to drink at the grandstand if they happen to win the race. It's like a thing.
Cool.
Yeah, so just a weird little thing.
Oh, but sure. It was influenced by sponsors. It was influenced by dairy companies trying to get in on the money.
I hear sponsors run the media. So they line up on the starting grid, and we get... Remember how we had the floating faces before? We get the faces of everyone that was involved in the montage, every member of Speed's family, every ally that he's had throughout the movie, floats past and behind him and stacks up behind him like he's Sailor Moon about to blast Queen Beryl.
"I hear you, Luna. I am not afraid anymore. I do need all of you. Please, help me."
Racers, start your engines.
And then it's on.
There is this really cool part of the early section of the race where there is a zoetrope going on the side of the racetrack that is a zebra galloping because, you know...
It is so cool.
Zoetropes are actually very important. They're one of our early pieces of animation. That's how we actually figured out that, yes, horses do lift all four hooves when they are galloping.
Amazing. And yeah, so alongside the track, they have these sort of 45-degree angle. The only thing I can compare them to is on some like newish wrestling rings, they actually have an LED screen along the apron that can, like, you know, show the name of the event or spark off when someone hits it. So at the very start, Speed is attacked, and the way he gets away is like he did at the rally. He rolls up onto one of these 45-degree thing, and he jump jacks directly laterally and smashes three other racers off the course.
This is such an incredible action sequence, this whole race, and it is going to be really difficult for us to really get onto, like, the specifics here, but what the vibe is that this is the culmination of everything that Speed has picked up throughout all the other races. It is so frenetic and somehow still incredibly fluid. It is a joy to watch.
And yes, Speed is completely in his element.
It's truly one of the best driving action sequences I've ever seen.
Because he's using his jump jacks, he's sliding around, he's spinning, he's taking people out, and nobody can touch him. Because he has built to this point, and his meter is so full, it is flashing gold. And he has got, you know, 2X, 4X, 6X combo going, and nobody can touch him. And he gets to the front against Cannonball Taylor, and guess what? He drives him into the ground.
He's like, "All right, Cannonball, teach me a lesson." And oh, there is nothing that Cannonball can teach Speed at this point.
They literally fence in midair at the top of the half pipe in opposite directions with their cars. Speed knocks him flat and he looks back and he says, "You get that weak shit off my track."
Speed said a cuss.
The only uncensored swear word of the movie.
Speed said a cuss.
He said a naughty word.
Remember in the first Agni Kai in Avatar The Last Airbender, when Zuko breaks Zhao's root and he's got him on the back foot? That's it. And Speed overtakes him so badly that he looks at him and he says, "Lesson's over. see you at the finish line. He leaves him in the dust.
Ugh.
Except
Cannonball can't take it. Cannonball was holding back this whole time, and now he is going to just go ahead and say screw it and use the spear hook.
And he spear hooks Speed, and you see Speed panic, but then remember how he got caught at Fuji. And it's a jump coming up, and he hits his boosters, and he turns the car so the cameras can look at the bottom of the car and see that he has been spear hooked before they crash off the track.
Which is so cool. He times the camera perfectly so that it's just got this, like, beautiful, gigantic shot of the spear hook mechanic.
Everyone watching the race is utterly aghast because this champion of racing, Royalton, the king of the industry, is cheating in the most important race in the season.
And this is live with millions of people watching. There is no getting out of this.
Cannonball crashes and goes into his quick save, and Speed stalls out and he can't start his car.
And we're at this point where this part of the track looks like a sort of drain circling thing. Cannonball just goes down the drain and Speed stalls out while a whole bunch of the other cars pass him by again.
And Speed stops for a second. He's frantic. He's talking to Sparky, and Sparky didn't know. And Pops in the stands knows exactly what's happened. It's his car. Of course he knows. He's like, the converter's loose. He needs to shift into fifth gear and jumpstart it. And Mom actually says, would he even know that? Would Sparky know that?
And there's just this horrible silence as Pops just stares at him because he knows that answer is no.
And he only knows it because he built it and it's his car. But then, you guys, Luke turns off his targeting computer.
He uses the Force.
Closes his eyes, and he's silent for a moment until we cut back to Racer X, who is watching this from behind glass, up in that viewing platform, essentially, like he was at the beginning of the movie. And he says, just listen, Speed. Just listen to her. And Speed asks the car quietly, what do you need? There's only one person who ever said, listen to the car.
God, this is such a good bit. It feels campy, but that's the beauty of it. They lean into the full camp of it, and it's wonderful.
Yeah, this is the pivotal moment of the movie because everything that they have shown you before has led to you buying into the conceit of the film enough that this feels not only correct, but a triumph. They told you that whole story so that they could tell you this right here.
It's not about doing all the right things to make your art work, all the right things to make your business work, all the right things to get noticed. It is about feeling what your art needs, what your goals need, your movies need to make them real.
And from an even further level than that, it is about being able to tell this story enough to someone else to make them believe it right along with you.
This is a good movie.
This is a good movie.
And Speed, against all odds, listens to the heart of the car, and he jumpstarts, pulls the gear into fifth, jumpstarts the car, and bursts out of that stall, and nothing can stop him now.
This sequence is, in a movie of beautiful things, this is a beautiful sequence because Speed is going, like, he starts in slow motion as he cuts the turn so we can see his face. And then at full speed, he passes the entire pack of racers without being touched. He's bouncing, spinning, moving between them. And the colors go from blurred, bright colors to gold, back to colors, and they puff away to dust. And Speed is running in black, surrounded by color particles.
Throughout this whole sequence, we hear voices, echoes of the rest of the movie, of everything good and bad that people have told him, the people who matter, the people who have hurt him, the people who have loved him.
It's everything is saying, this is the moment. Everything in this movie, remember it all, because it all matters now, and it is about to be paid off.
And
it builds and it builds and it builds.
When you figure out what you're racing for, we hope we're here to see it.
And one statement is said again, with the meaning changed from a degrading sentence to an affirmation. Racing hasn't changed, and it never will. I just realized I skipped. There's a bit with Grey Ghost. It doesn't matter. We're just going to go straight through the end.
Yeah. With a mighty explosion, he wrecks the last two cars in front of him and blasts over the finish line in first place.
And Speed breathes. He takes off his helmet. And suddenly, the entire audience is here to cheer him on.
And when he crossed that finish line, it wasn't just a flag. It turned into a tube with checkers all around him.
It did.
Feeding him through to the victory lane.
It was like his whole sequence when he was imagining racing and winning when he was a child. This tube, this portal.
Oh, you're right.
Meanwhile, while this is happening, Royalton is ruined. He is throwing things in his suite. And I forget who says it. Someone says it to Racer X and says, this could change everything. And Racer X says it already has.
It's his girlfriend. She says that.
Oh, she does get to speak. Hooray!
He already changed everything. He already did. And Inspector Detector, as the furor dies down, turns to Racer X and says, hey, my men are bringing the family down to Speed. Do you want to go with them? And Racer X pauses. And Inspector Detector follows that up with, do you ever think you made a mistake? Hiding the truth from them? And we flash back to the ice pass.
And it's Rex blowing up his own car from a distance with a body inside. And then going to have magical plastic surgery that looks incredibly painful to change him from Rex Racer.
That turns him into
Jack from Lost.
To the guy from Lost? He watches his own funeral and everything. And he just says, if I did, it's a mistake I have to live with.
So then Sparky and Speed are in the winner's ring, and Speed has a drink and immediately passes the milk to Sparky, and Sparky gets to drink the milk in victory lane.
In the conversation between Sparky and Speed, Sparky was like, he said things that you would expect Speed to say, like, I never thought I'd be here. I never thought I'd be spotting for a guy at this world stage. Mm-hmm. For him, in his field, this is just as big a deal as Speed in his field.
Yeah.
And Speed shows that Sparky deserves to be here just as much as he does, because he couldn't have made it there without him.
It's just like in Pixar's Cars, the team is as important as the racer. Except we don't have to deal with Larry the Cable Guy, we just have to deal with a chimpanzee in a tux.
And what does Speed do when the others get on stage?
Well, his parents are so proud of him. They all hug him. And also Trixie's here. She looks like a million bucks. And Speed remembers the thing that he said he was going to do if he won. To really remind Trixie exactly how much sense it makes to be with her.
And he takes her in his arms. And he dips her. And he kisses her. But...
And we're not going to talk about the thing that Squirtle and Chip Chip do. He kisses her.
He kisses her.
He kisses her full on the lips, and it's fantastic.
And all the cameras flash. We don't worry about what that kid and goddamn monkey are doing. Didn't happen.
Because, meh, cooties, shut up. And we find out that Royalton was arrested. The Racer family is doing great, just over some like news headlines that fly by and magazine tabloids. Everything is as it should be. Then it jumps to the end credits, which is this, like, hi-fi remix of the Mach Go 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 theme.
With the freestyle rapped across it.
Yes.
Because it was 2008.
Because it was 2008. We weren't doing power ballads at that point. We were doing rap remixes.
Overlaid with them getting their money's worth for the trained monkey as he dances around and does weird shit.
Yeah, side note, this movie did not have the no animals were harmed seal of approval.
It didn't?
No, I'll tell you why. Because...
Oh, no.
The chimp bit a Spritel stand-in badly enough that one of the crew people started hitting the ape to get him to let go. And it was a moment of passion. A monkey bit a kid and a guy got scared. But because of that, and also, quote, five piranhas dying under mysterious circumstances, they did not get the seal of approval.
No.
Oh, shit.
I didn't think they were real piranhas. They look a lot like CGI piranhas, you guys.
Yeah, I thought they were CG too.
Maybe they were CG because of what something happened to the real ones.
Oh, no.
But this is a hell of a movie.
Oh.
Yeah, that's Speed Racer.
Speed fucking Racer, y'all.
And this died a horrible death at the box office. It was $120 million it cost to make it, and they made back 90. Christina Ricci didn't act for a while until it was, like, I think it was like The City of Zed and then Yellow Jackets that really brought her back. Emil Hirsch really didn't do anything. And then in 2015, he drunkenly assaulted an assistant and pled guilty to that. And he kind of went away.
Yeah, that's probably... Yeah.
Yeah, it's bad. But look, this movie... In the last maybe 7 or 8 years, maybe a little more, has gotten the critical reevaluation that it needed, that it deserved. It is now seen as a classic for a reason.
I feel like now that sort of the Matrix mania that was present in that part of the aughts has sort of faded, we're able to sort of look back at the Wachowski films with maybe a broader scope and appreciation for the stuff that worked and the stuff that didn't work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And also, a lot of it makes a lot more sense in hindsight now that they are both out.
Yeah.
Yeah. You can really see it.
And also just knowing like all the problems they had, like trying to be forced into making a Matrix sequel and all of their other movies and marketing and stuff. And it's like all that stuff that's in the first like 45 minutes of the Matrix Resurrections. I'm sure a lot of that is based on what led to this movie.
You know, I really ought to watch Matrix Resurrections soon, given how much I liked the first one.
It's fine. I had a good time. I think we have well and truly proven that you can do what you love and make art and create beauty in the face of corporate greed and a capitalist hellscape. So I think it's time for our final facts. Annie, what's your final fact?
God, you know, I think I've been coming to this a lot lately, but I just have so many feelings about it. I feel like my final fact is art is a necessary good for the human soul, and it deserves to be made with or without the meddling of corporate interests. Make art because you need to, because you cannot be human without it.
That's a good final fact.
Anna, what's your final fact?
Don't forget your cootie shot!
Oh god, I just gagged on my water.
No, my real final fact is there is a time and a place for slapstick comedy. You would think it would be in a crazy anime-inspired racing movie. Apparently, it is not.
Oh, yeah. Can I have a second final fact?
Yeah.
Our ones always have multiple final facts.
How dare you interrupt Christina Ricci when she's being hot on camera? How dare you?
How dare you?
Not cool.
Lucas, what is your final fact?
On a day where AI theft is running rampant and algorithms are keeping you down, just remember, that guy's a crook. Don't believe crooks.
Hell yeah.
Hell yeah. Don't believe crooks.
That is going to do it for us here today. The main I Will Fight You team is going to be back next time for Tu Wong Fu, Thanks for Everything, Love, Julie Newmar, which is a hell of a mouthful of a movie. We'll also have a special guest on at that point, Megan Bob of our sort of sister podcast, Hard Choices, which is just a delight. I'm so happy every time I get to be on that one.
The horny older trash sibling.
Yes.
Hell yeah. Megan Bob is fantastic. We love them.
We love a Megan Bob.
I'm so excited to have them on, and I'm so excited for y'all to listen to it.
If any of our listeners have not listened to Megan Bob's works before, they are in for something real special.
Especially for this gay-ass movie.
Oh, yeah.
All right, you want me to do it? I'll do it. I think I'm better at it this time.
You want to take another run at it?
Take another crack at it. Lucas, Lucas, Lucas.
Oh, I Will Fight You comes out every 5 weeks. This is edited by me, Lucas Brown, of the Math of You podcast. If you want to follow us on social media, it is crcpodcast.bsky.social. It is also crookedrussiancam.tumblr.com. If you want to give money, it is patreon.com/thejemjam. You can get early access to episodes. Annie writes a bunch of stuff. There's a huge backlog of bonus content that is very, very funny. And some of it has been in my feed as I blew through it because I ran out of other podcasts to listen to. And I'm like, what if I just listen to my friends talk about nice things for 10 minutes at a time? So I listen to all the mini fic flick.
Oh, buddy.
Aw.
So you can do that. You can give a little bit of money. A dollar always helps. There's also some really high tiers. You could like fin dom us a lot. We'd be so impressed if you did that. Cool beans.
Look, we just told you on the Patreon, do not do this. And sometimes people do, and we don't know how to deal with it.
We don't. It's...
Unless...
Yeah, don't findom us, haha, unless. No, really, don't findom us, haha, unless.
Don't throw me in the briar patch.
No siree.
Thank you for funding our hosting fees and for paying for Lucas and Jake to edit our podcast. Thank you.
From the bottom of our hearts, thank you.
Money can be exchanged for goods and services.
Yes.
But also a like, rating, subscribe wherever you see podcasts really helps metrics, helps people find the show, and also tell someone. Hey, I was at a party and I told somebody, and I was like, hey, it's this cool podcast. We're going to be talking about Speed Racer.
Aww.
So yeah, you could do that. The power is yours.
That's a thing you can do with your mouth.
You could be that person. And then you could tell us that you did it, and I'll be like, aww.
We could call you like an influencer. Anyway, you can go and find everything that the shows do at crookedrussiancam.horse or .gay if you're nasty.
Aw, shit. I think you did it, bud.
Hell yeah.
He did it. Holy
hell
shit.
Hell yeah.
Get that weak shit off my track.
So that is going to do it for us. Join us next time for regular flavor, I Will Fight You. And look forward to more Wolfpacks in the future. We're having fun doing these with more movies per movie.
And that's a guarantee.
The most movie per movie.
Until next time, I'm Annie.
I'm Lucas.
And I am Anna.
And we have fought you.
Ow, Wolfpäc.
Ow.
We probably put Lucas in the middle to break up the two AN names.
Sure.
I'm different.
You're different.
I'm the Crow T robot of this podcast.
Hi, different. I'm Anna.
Oh, ouch.
I'm getting a head start on the dad jokes, even though I have no kids.
Oh, no. Am I the Mike? Am I the Joel?
You're more of a Joel. How do you feel towards prop comedy?
Not great. Not a fan.
Is there a joke here? I'm too young to get.
Mystery Science Theater 3000 was a television show that was on for a long time involving several robots and a nerd stuck on a satellite. And Annie just realized that she is that nerd.
Oh, I know about MST3K, but I've never seen it.
Oh, and we're going to curate you a list.
Yeah, no. When Lucas was saying I'm different, he was referencing one of the intro call-outs for Crow T Robot.
Got it. I'm with you now.
Yeah. So they would call out his name and he would go, I'm different, in the back.
I'm different, because he was voiced by a different person at that point.
Right.
Anyway.
That's Watto.
Jesus. Jesus Christ.
My brain is currently painting my ceiling.
Oh, my bean.
Freak the bean.
My bean.
Freak the whole bean.
Oh, God. My bean.
My bean.
Bean freaking. Is that what the kids are calling it these days?
That's not making the episode. And now you're getting reamed out in front. You're getting chewed out in front of your date, and it's the worst thing.
Oh, man. And
you're getting reamed instead of getting reamed.
I changed that specifically to avoid that joke. But
I have no such scruples.
Rex goes home. Sorry. Speed goes home. And
Rex. But Rex is dead. Rex wasn't
dead,
in this
Lucas.
Movie.
Rex not in the movie.
I don't think we need to plug you guys because you're just here now.
It's true.
We're just
we've been here the whole time.